Okay. Well, welcome. Welcome, everyone. It's going to be another spontaneous night. I'm always joyful, but oh my gosh, spending that 4.5 hours with Judy Sketch and Wit, oh, I feel like high as a kite. Like I'm you have to peel me off the ceiling. These are like the founders, you know, Judy's one of the original four, and then Wit, she married William Whitson, and then Deborah Roberts is so devoted with the Foundation for Inner Peace, the copyright holders of the course, and they've just lived a life of devotion. I don't know if some of you know the story, but you know, in this world, everything's about comparison, competition, and sometimes they say this is a world of like pairs. Everything's in opposites, and even relationships are partnerships. And the ego has some sayings about that. Two's company, three's a crowd. Three makes it difficult. Or don't they call them triangles sometimes? Of course, we're out in the Bay Area, so, you know, we're just broadcasting to the rest of the world, but we're in the Bay Area, and you know, they have communes and all kinds of configuration. If the world wants to learn about the possibilities of human relationships, just come live in the Bay Area for a little while, and then you'll really get a chance to see what's going on here. But what I like about them is Judy was married to Bob Scutch, and then Jesus actually intervened in a marriage and reconfigured the marriage. So she was guided by Spirit to leave her husband and to marry another man. And the three of them have worked together for these 38 years that they've been married, and before. They're still working together in a joining that's beyond collaboration. It's divinely inspired. You might say Christ is just working through those three as well as all the rest of us, but to me that's very, very inspiring to live a life devoted. Also, they've been together in a world where there's so many changing relationships and people come and go from people's lives. These original four and the ones that came after had a cohesiveness that was based on a purpose not of this world. They had to deliver something that would be basically turn into the symbol of the escape hatch from time and space in terms of this planet. And the Course in Miracles, again, it's just a book, so it's just a symbol. Who you are, who your very being is the escape hatch. And sometimes people in Christianity will say, well, Jesus came 2,000 years ago and they've been waiting for decades and centuries for the second coming of Christ, but you and I, remembering who we are and who our Creator is the second coming of Christ. We don't have to wait for someone to come on a white horse and send some to hell and pull some up into the light. It's when we're ready to forgive and see ourselves as the living Christ, then that's the second coming of Christ. It's really remembering our creation, remembering our source. So it's just an honor. I feel really honored today. I always feel honored, but after this afternoon, I feel more honored than ever. But here comes more lighting.
I'm seeing if it'll help or won't help.
Yeah, this is good. We're testing it out. It will at least light the roses up. Let's see how this works. Okay.
Good.
Wow. Even better.
Is it nice?
It's nice.
Thank you.
Oh, that's right. Oh, look, you have a face.
I have a face now. It's a glowing face. A nice golden tint, a golden hue has come over me. So, yeah, I just feel like this evening can be a deep joining of connectedness where we really invite the Holy Spirit to just come and descend on us and have that deep, mystical, sacred feeling of who we are and who we've always been and who we will forever be, that is so glorious and so sublime and really just shines away every sense of ego familiarity, every sense of the past, every scrap of the past, so that we can meet in this holy instant as if for the very first time, of not knowing anything of anyone based on form or the body, just coming into that transcendent experience that our mind is a vessel for Christ to shine through, a perfect translucent vehicle for light and love to shine. And we pray that if there's any scrap of fear or doubt or darkness that would block the light, we ask that it be shown to us so that we can voluntarily give it over to Spirit. Because that's how the healing occurs, when we don't cling to or hold on to or protect the darkness, then the darkness is given over to the light and it just disappears. It's like ignorance coming into wisdom, and then the ignorance is gone and only wisdom remains. That's how the awakening occurs. So that's been my prayer, is to be the living presence of Christ. And then it was interesting at the lunch today, because at one point Whit and Judy were recalling when they, Whit said, well, I asked Bill Thetford one time, how do you know how it's going in the plan of awakening, and how well you've done, how much you've accomplished in your part of awakening? And Bill had a beautiful quote from the Course, and then they shared that, and then they asked me directly, how do you know how much you've done in terms of fulfilling the part that you're to play and everything? And the thing that just came immediately to my mind was when Jesus starts out a sentence in the Course with the one right use of judgment, because to me that's a fascinating way to begin a sentence, because Jesus is known for the Sermon on the Mount, and most specifically for teaching in the Bible, judge not lest you be judged. So when Jesus Christ starts out a sentence with the one right use of judgment, that gets my attention. That piques my attention. I can't wait to hear what he's going to follow that up with. And in the Course he says the one right use of judgment is the question, how do you feel? So he's saying that we still have this barometer in us that can still tell us how tuned in we are, how aligned we are with Spirit. How do you feel? And so I would add just one word at the end of that. How do I feel now? That is telling me how things are going. And if you keep that barometer open and you keep tuned in and you pay attention to that, wow, that's taking us all the way back to the gateway to heaven. That we are responsible for how we feel. And we are being informed and instructed on how to purify our hearts and to live in joy and peace. And Judy added one word to joy and peace. She said, wonder. 84 years old, and wonder. And I said, like, yeah, that wonder in the terms of awe, feeling awe in the presence of the Creator. Almost like a childlike awe, like, oh, Abba, Father, Papa, Father, you know, oh my God, you know, what can I do to serve you? What can I do to glorify you? How humble that is, how absolutely humble. So, yeah, I just love to come and join and connect in with everyone and let the Spirit bring clarity to us, make quick our way, so we hasten unto the kingdom of heaven, that we not delay in time and space, that the Holy Spirit wishes us no delay, that in the attainment of the real world section of the Course, Jesus is saying that the Holy Spirit will give you everything that you need and will renew it as long as you have need of it. That's your life insurance policy. That's your health insurance policy. That's your economic sustenance. That's your nutrition. That's your safety. That's your security. The Holy Spirit will give you everything that you need in the awakening and will renew it as long as you have need of it. Okay, that's spectacular. There's more, but there's a comma. There's even more. As long as you believe that you're here, but the Holy Spirit will not have you linger in time. So, wow, give me everything I need in the awakening, renew it as long as I have need of it, but would not have me delay and linger in time. Which at that last part is important too. Will not have me misuse the symbols of time and space to cling to time when my home is eternity. It's even got that fail-safe part of all this divine providence. Divine providence lavished on us, on our mind, and no delay and no lingering. Which means that sometimes in our perception of the world, it will seem as if things are being taken away. That's even from the manual for teachers. The stages of the development of trust. One of the stages where it will seem as if things are being taken away is not really the case. It's just that our mind is devaluing the things of time and space, and certain things we have no longer need of, and they disappear from our perception. This can be relationships, it can be houses, cars, children, animals, it can be even our memory. You know, we can pride ourselves in having a good memory. Well, William Whitson was talking about an encounter he had with a dear friend who went into Alzheimer's, and he got more childlike and more childlike, and then as he kept visiting him, he couldn't remember things. He pointed over, Judy was saying, he pointed over to his wife, and he just said, she says she's my wife. And he got so childlike that his wife bought him a big sandbox to play in, because she was so tuned in and loving to his state of mind, and they would play together in the sandbox as they got up in years. And then he would take some little things and he would make a little city, and he would say, this is God's city. He called it God's city. And they did publish, he was Swedish, so they published the Swedish version of A Course in Miracles, and he kept that Swedish Course in Miracles near him all the time. He carried it around with him. And then when Witt asked him, what's that? What's that that you're carrying? And he said, it's the voice of God. So he played in the sandbox with God's city, and he carried his little course book around, Swedish book around, saying it's the voice of God, and didn't seem to know much else. Those were the most of the ideas that he could really hold together. And it reminded me of my grandmother, Lillian, who was diagnosed with dementia, and she got happier and happier and happier the farther along she went into the condition. Legally blind, diagnosed with dementia, short-term memory blows out, and long-term memory, well, she remembers the 23rd Psalm. I don't even know the whole 23rd Psalm. She could verbatim go through, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Couldn't tell you who she had lunch with, couldn't tell you what happened during the day, but could sing these old Christian hymns of praise to God. She'd remember every line and every note and everything of the melody, and have the whole nursing home singing along with her. I'd go to visit her and look around, the halls are vacant. I said, where does everyone go? They're in the cafeteria singing with Lillian. The further she got into her dementia, the more she got into the presence of love. And sometimes I would even push her around in the nursing home for a while, and then she would look at me and love me. She was legally blind, but she would just kind of, just like I was anyone else in her life. And then finally, sometimes she'd turn and she'd go, Dave, is that you? Just like an instant little flick of a memory or a recognition. So yeah, that really, the more we talked today, I thought, that's where this is heading, where we get so happy and our seeming skill level and education level and memories of the specifics of this world start to fade and fade and get grow dim and disappear. And Whit and I were, Whit was saying, yeah, it seems like that's getting close to the happy dream and the real world. I know in my own life, I got to a point with the Course after I read it 8 hours a day and just immersed in it so much that I would show up in the early Course groups, like in the late 1980s, and I would start talking and people would ask a question and all sentences, paragraphs would even come out verbatim from my mouth, and also what page number and so on and so forth, and people would go, oh, God, he can't possibly be, and then they go, ah! It's actually right, you know, they couldn't believe that someone could memorize the Course. But there came a point, too, where I remember in Lesson 189, forget this world, forget this Course, and come with holy empty hands unto your God, where I could feel Jesus was going the other direction. Like, you don't have to verbatim quote scripture of the Course. You have to be happy. You have to go into joy. You have to move into an experience. That's what I want you to do, not be like some kind of scribe or Pharisee or you know, quoter of the book. I want you to have an experience. I want you to go beyond the words. So that launched a whole new phase. And I have to say, yeah, I've been having a lot of quiet time in the recent months, and yeah, this is a kind of a rare, quick, spontaneous little tour with Nikita and I shooting through California and doing some speaking. But yeah, when I was down in LA, I had to, ooh, talking, this is what, that's right, I better exercise the vocal cords a little bit, because it's this strange thing. Oh, talking, yeah, I remember that. It has to come back to me. So yeah, that's the beauty of this, I think, is just to be in that real devotional life and sink more and more into what I call the still mind, just pristine stillness with no yakety-yak going on in there, no committee meeting to try to decide what to do, just given in a very natural way. Seems like not too long ago, I was here in Northern California, and then I had lunch with Sundari and Judy's daughter, who Judy's daughter's age, Tamara's age, and the body of David are both the same number of years, 58 years old. And I don't know if any of you ever saw those old videos, there's really only one that goes way back, the story of A Course in Miracles. But in that one, you know, you have Helen Schuckman, and she goes through her vivid dreams, and you know, all these, it's kind of cool, all, and you know, the inner voice saying, this is A Course in Miracles, please take notes and everything. But there's some scenes over about like a cave over in the Israel, what we would call Israel or Galilee, in which she goes into a cave, and some of you remember the clearing off the getting the scrolls, the gold-tipped scrolls, and then opening up the scrolls and little tiny letters appearing inside the scroll. And then the voice inside of Helen's mind saying, you know, if you roll it to the left, you can read the past. And if you roll it to the right, you can read the future. And Helen going, no, I'm not interested in that. And she just rolls the scrolls back with all the tiny little letters, and there's only two words that are left in the center of these scrolls. God is. And she, rolls it back, and she's content with God is, not knowing the future or the past. And then the voice inside says, good, you made it this time. Yeah. And that was one of the preliminary experiences that Helen had before she began taking down, this is A Course in Miracles, please take notes. So, but in that cute little story of A Course in Miracles, there was a scene where also where she was going down a little stream in a boat, some of you remember, and was wearing like a hood, kind of a gown with a hood. And then she's streaming of buried treasure, and she says, I wonder if there's buried treasure underneath. So she gets a little pole thing, and she reaches down, and she pulls up a trunk into the boat, and I think she opens it up, and there's a book in it, and it has Aesculapius, which is, I think, the Greek god of healing. It's the name of the book, forecasting again that she would have something to do with a book on healing, using symbology of the world. But some point I was wondering, I said, how did you make that movie? I think I had asked her some other time, during lunchtime with her back around 12 years ago. I had lunch with her a few times, and she said, that was my daughter Tamara. We dressed her up and we put on her. She is probably a teenager. I said, that's helped. That dates the body of David. I was a teenager back at that same, we're both the same age. Imagine being a teenager and having Helen Schuckman hanging around you and your mother about this book, A Course in Miracles, and growing up in that home. What a teenage years, you know, to grow up in. Very exciting. So I was very happy when Sundari said, we're going to go over and meet Tam. And Kirsten and I went with Sundari, and just absolutely delightful. And to feel the deep connection with her, you know, she's just, oh, it's so cool out here in California. You have so many cool people. She's like, oh, she's giving me a tour of her little place. She said, oh, and here's a spare bedroom, David. You can come and stay here whenever you want. I'm like, oh, it's just so adorable. You know, and she's going to be taking over the foundation as Judy and Whit, her and Bob Rosenthal. Bob's going to move out to the area. So the beat goes on. I said, well, we're going to collaborate with you and join with you and in honor and respect for all those that have been before us, that come before us, to bring this beautiful scripture from Jesus into our lives that's so practical, that we can practice in our lives every day of the year, and we can do it without interrupting our regular activities in any way, just by tuning in to these beautiful lessons that are so impactful and can be transferred so effectively to clear our minds, like a meditation program from Jesus. It's like a guided meditation program, instructions, daily lessons. Amazing, absolutely amazing. So tonight, I just want to join with everybody, and I am fully available and open for any questions. I had so much fun with Judy today because my buddy Gary Renard, I saw him on a recent Bat Gap program, Buddha at the Gas Pump. At the very end of the talk, he said something like, Helen Schuckman is back in this lifetime, and she will experience enlightenment. And so I had to ask Judy about that, and just got an amazing context to the whole thing, and then a full-blown answer from her, what she thought about that, including the context of, well, reincarnation is just a symbol, and really, we don't have lives, so to speak, that we're here just watching symbols, dreaming that we're apart from God, and really we're reviewing what has already gone by. This world's over and done, and we're just reviewing the past and thinking it's still going on. So there's a time issue underneath everything, and we're here to undo that time issue. And that's one of the deepest experiences that we have. It's one of the, you might say, that's like the pool of a backdrop that seemed to be assumed as real for the human being. But actually that itself is part of an opportunity to forgive and to come back to the holy instant. And we did have some interesting discussions about the simultaneity of time. I love that that's where Judy and Whit are. That's the kind of discussions they're having about time being simultaneous. 84 and 87 years old, and that's sharp as a tack, both of them. The memories, the clarity, the experiences just come pouring out and rushing out. And that's kind of at the bottom of it all. Letting go of that. So I'm here, I open myself up, just so happy to be here with all of you and see dear friends and new friends here, and yeah, I'm open to talk about any topics or curiosities or issues you have going on in your life that you think you'd like a little more clarity on, anything that could be truly helpful. Yeah. Yes.
Do you dream?
Well, it's kind of interesting because I don't really, there were times in my life where I would wake up and write them down and this, but I don't really have an awareness of that, other than that sense that Jesus says you're dreaming all the time. So he's implying you're dreaming at night, or you're dreaming at day, and he doesn't even make distinctions between nighttime dreams and daydreaming, or what we would call daily life. But so in the sense that I'm perceiving a room full of people, yes, I do dream. If you're kind of meaning nighttime dreams, what seems to happen is that when people live with me or are around me, I don't seem to have any dreams or anything to talk about of the sort at all, but their nighttime dreams are stirred up big time when people are around me. So I just was in Southern California, and the man down there, Chris, who introduced the whole little tribe down there to me on YouTube, he came over for a weekend retreat, and he was out in the tent and walking in, and whoa, those were some major intense nighttime dreams. And he said, I'm so glad when I woke up that those weren't real, they were so intense. So I don't really, you know, have an experience of dreaming nighttime dreams at all, but the people around me seem to, it flushes up all kinds of things into their awareness. And then we were laughing because he was saying, yeah, I know, I control things so much during my daytime dreams that the unconscious just wildly pops out at night. And I think a lot of people have that experience, you know, fairly things under control during the day, and yet if there's unconscious wishes and desires, Freud had that part right. Dreams are wish fulfillment. So if the ego can't fulfill its fantasies during the daytime, it will do it at night. And many people report flying dreams and tell me amazing nighttime dreams. That are all kind of their mind exploring things, and they're just kind of noticing the elements that are coming up during those nighttime dreams. So usually I'm just kind of there to offer some hints or maybe even some suggestions or advice on those themes when they tell them to me. But yeah, mine seems to be a blank slate.
Yeah, that's pretty, that's what I thought, because a friend of mine spent a month in Bali with a teacher, and he was pretty aware and awakened. But he basically said, you know, one thing that tells him that he's not, like, fully free is that he was still dreaming. And he said he had met many teachers who their waking and sleeping state is the same. There's no difference, and they don't have dreams anymore. So I just thought, I should ask David.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think anyone's asked me that before, so. David.
I have a question about psychic phenomena and psychic experiences, because I know what the Course teaches is if I'm experiencing psychic phenomena, then it's just my own thoughts. And I know that you, as a teacher of the Course, you know, teach exactly the same thing. But I feel like it's, like, radically different from what I believe. Because, like, my previous spiritual practice, you know, was all about, like, psychic phenomena and psychic experiences and being, you know, being affected by other people or situations. So it's like, I guess, you know, the Course's thought system is something that I want to believe, but I still have some investment in, like, the external world. I feel there's still like a cause in the world for my state of mind. It's kind of strange that I've studied the Course for a long time, but I still feel resistance to the thought system. So I wonder if you could talk about that.
Yeah, I do meet a lot of people that have a wide variety of psychic phenomena, and it varies in intensity. And just when I was in Southern California, the mother of my host was saying, yes, yeah, she has a lot of psychic phenomena that's part of her life and part of her profession and so forth. And she was wondering, is this good or not good, or what's the course have to say about this? And I said, well, it's not so much about the psychic phenomena per se, but it's the purpose. Like, what is the purpose underneath it? Like, for example, with fortune telling or past life regression or psychic phenomenon like remote viewing, and there's just so many, psychokinesis and so on and so forth, premonitions and on and on. Is it being used by the ego to reinforce a bodily identity, a personality identity, or is it being used to heal and to bless? Just coming in as an occasional inspiration, like doing a reading for somebody that really helps them kind of see something that's blocking the way in their mind, or something, a reading that comes and somehow gives hope or inspiration to someone when they're in a period of depression or despair. So the use of the psychic phenomenon is the most important thing, and that's what I was talking to this woman about, because the mind, it's so easy to get preoccupied with the things, and that's one of the things that Judy and Whit were talking with me about reincarnation, how even reincarnation, Judy was saying she has some friends, and they say they were part of the founding forefathers of the United States, and they meet every so often to talk about these things and everything, but if it's about the past and somehow feeling special or feeling different or unique or different from everybody else, then the ego is actually using these psychic phenomena to keep the mind locked in a body identity and locked in a personality, instead of seeing, oh my gosh, everything's for the whole. It's just one mind awakening. And if you actually counsel somebody and help somebody using these psychic phenomena, then it's such a blessing. Or like, I always think of the Dionne Warwick's psychic hotline, you know, if it becomes a business, you know, I mean, even psychic readings could become a profession and a career. A career for who? For the personality. You see, spirit doesn't have a career. So spirit would be using all of these psychic phenomena to take you away from a personal mask or a personality. And the ego says, oh no, you can be a famous psychic or a famous magician or a famous whatever, even a famous miracle worker. The ego would want you to draw attention to a personality self, a famous teacher. You know, it's always trying to use fame to hold on to that mask, that personality self. And the Holy Spirit is so humble that it's more like the Bible says, you know, the Holy Spirit is like the wind. No one knows where the wind comes from or where it goes. The Holy Spirit is like the core principle of Alcoholics Anonymous, and 12 steps is anonymous. That's why they call it Alcoholics Anonymous, not Alcoholics Famous Healer or Alcoholics Famous Sponsor. No, it's Alcoholics Anonymous, because the Spirit doesn't have a body identity, and it's wanting us to remember that. Yeah. Yes, Sundari.
I don't know why these two are coming together, these two questions, but they're coming together as one. Today, it was very interesting to me when we were talking about bringing the darkness to the light. And there are certain situations where, like expression sessions or speaking one's truth, where it's obvious to me what that means rather than keeping things hidden. And then there's situations that are not so clear, I was talking about this decoding philosophy of finding the causative thought behind each disease and this process of decoding having a manual. And I couldn't see then about how, which way was bringing the darkness to the light. And the bigger, I don't know why this is all together, but the big a thing that's up for me right now is I have a son who's always lived with me. And I can feel his desire to be free and independent, and the kind of terror and paralysis behind taking those steps and also being comfortable. And I feel, it worked for a while, you know, we would sort of work the chores and work the stuff, and maybe about a couple years ago, it got to where he's angry about it, and it's directed at me, and so the household doesn't feel as peaceful. And I think that's his own frustration. And there's a place that he'd like to go that I have, the ranch I have. But then there's a renter with a sick wife, and we're sort of in paralysis about that. And so the way that relates to the other question is I've put it in my little God can. You know, the little box that's, you know, God can. And so I stick it in there to remember that God can, and I... well, you know, instead of me thinking that I can,
that's,
you know, so
nice.
I was 10, so
but God
I,
can.
Little heart thing. And, you know, I just keep sticking in there to remind me that God can. And so I've done this for years and years and gotten to the point of, oh, I should kick him out and get with Mom, and I should, and waiting for guidance and waiting for guidance and waiting for guidance, and it just not being clear. And you know, on and on and on and on. And so I feel that's sort of the process of bringing to the light, and yet the peace of, it's an uncomfortable, ongoing solution where everything feels stuck in it.
Yeah.
And so I guess I'm looking for the way to bring that to the light in a more effective way to bring peace to my son and peace to the household, either together or apart, or whatever way the story is supposed to unfold.
Yeah. Well, it's great because you've been, you know, hosting us here and to the monastery, and you know, you see the value of the two guidelines, no people pleasing, no private thoughts. You've been involved here and nearby and locally in amazing expression sessions and seeing the value of that. Now it's just time to, like the old lighthouse, let the light spin around and touch every aspect of your life, including your son. So those good old heart-to-heart expression sessions, if there's a stuckness, then there's some fear under the surface that still is being held onto. And it could be the fear of letting go of a son, even, you know, the good mother concept, and you know, you've talked about that even with your daughter. That's something that has been coming in for you and coming in, and you've had to, that aspect of it resolved itself, and now you just want the light to gently sweep around all of your mind, like a lighthouse in the night, how it just sweeps around, the light goes 360. It's just that the light sweep across our mind with no interference, with no resistance, or not hiding, holding anything, a little corral apart from the light that we were talking about. You don't want to protect anything. You would give all to the Holy Spirit. So I think just that heart-to-heart joining of, I'm sure David has his aspirations, his interest. I already have had some of his pumpkin pancakes, or sweet potato pancakes. That is right, pumpkin pancakes was self- in Southern California, and so I've had blueberry pancakes on this trip. It's such a short trip, blueberry pancakes, pumpkin, and sweet potato pancakes. Holy Spirit's like, I don't know, giving me pancakes everywhere. But it was delicious. They were absolutely delicious, you know. I'm having a pancake fest on this trip to California, but to have a heart-to-heart talk about, well, what's some of the aspirations, because if you're, if there's some anger or resentment and you're feeling it telepathically, you're tuning into it, and the Course is basically saying it's all one mind, so I'm responsible for what I see, what I perceive, I choose the feelings I experience, and I decide upon the goal I would achieve, and everything that seems to happen to me I ask for and receive as I have asked. So you can see, well, even if I perceive that there's some resistance or anger with my son in my house, then it's like, oh, then there's something in my perceptual world where there is some anger coming up. And so I would say there's definitely some protectionism and some people-pleasing going on, and it's always in our mind around certain concepts, like we hold on to a concept, and then we've got all these duties and obligations and responsibility that are tied and wound into these concepts. And the spirit's like, bring them up, let them come up, let's look at them together, and then they'll dissolve. And that's how the process works, bringing the darkness to the light, bringing the concepts to the light, and they just kind of just completely dissolve as we offer them over. So it would be like, I think a loving thing to do with like what seems to be an adult child in the house would be to sit down with a good old loving heart to heart and pray and say, how can I help you? How can I assist you? You know, some families throughout the ages have done it in different ways. Sometimes they put money away for a college fund, or they'll have a trust fund, or they'll say, I'll support you to a point. And you, all those kind of things, you know, are a little, all they are like steps. But the key point is the joining. It's like the joining and the praying together and the listening, saying, tell me, what is it that you feel? Because if there's any kind of fear of going out, or if he has expressed like this other property that you have, that we've talked about a number of times and everything, even if there's some pleasing going on around the family that's there, it's this thing of what will serve the whole. You know, it's if you have this thing like, I can't put them out, as if like you personally can say it's time to vacate and that you are the bad one or the bad guy in the whole thing. You know, it's more of like, well, what serves the whole? And it can be, again, through the joining in the prayer, like you said, maybe both of you have joined and both of you feel pressured by that, you know, like, I don't want to do that. And, you know, those are the kind of decisions that the Spirit has us really honestly look at, because the Spirit's task is to unwind us from guilt. And as long as there's guilt around anything in this world, there's always beliefs in letting some people down, hurting people's feelings, and so on and so forth. And the way shower is Jesus. He definitely didn't seem too interested or concerned about hurting anybody's feelings. I mean, during those 3 years of public ministry, it just seems like the more he let that gentle presence, but uncompromising presence, come through him, the angrier the people got around him. Until after 3 years, it was an angry mob. Some of us have seen the Jesus of Nazareth movie, where you've got this whole mob there after 3 years screaming, crucify him, crucify him. They were furious. And he was so gentle and meek, and yet his teachings were so otherworldly. I have a feeling even Mary, Joseph, any kind of biological family relatives were... If you imagine if somebody in your own family started saying, before Abraham was, I am, and I and the Father are one. Imagine with your brothers and sisters, if or husband's wife. Imagine if Bill started came home with, Gia, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You know, imagine, it's going to stir things up for human beings, no matter who's saying it. Just imagine in your own family. So there's a divinity in us that wants to express, that is sure of its identity, that is sure of its source. And we're all called to reach that place of certainty through many miracles, you know, many, many miracles. Of course, I always tell people, you're a saint in training. They like that. They go, they hear the first word, they go, in training. Okay, that sounds pretty good, actually, saint in training. But really, when you think you're a saint in training, and so is David. I mean, we're here for the most holy purpose ever. And to come together and say, okay, how can I support you in taking those steps where you can go for something that you really can put your heart and soul in, something that really inspires you. How can I support that? Even if it would be him going out and living on the land, you know, I think if that's something that he's kind of drawn to, it's something that I think needs careful prayer and consideration, because it is available. There's no doubt. It's just sometimes the ego will throw guilt in to try to say, oh, it's not really available, but it actually is available. And I feel like there's a big trust with that we don't really have the power to hurt other people's feelings. We just have the power to tune into the source and say, you lead the way, you show me, and I will follow. So a lot of decisions that I seem to make in the parable of David, there's a lot of decisions that I would say were not really popular, especially as I got deeper and deeper in with it. Popular initially with parents or my sister or friends. I mean, as I've gone deeper, I've even had Course in Miracle friends over the years, which I thought, this is my tribe. But as I go radically into divine providence and trust, radically into make no compromises, you know, decide everything for the whole, for the good of the whole, then sometimes even what seems to be friendships, even Course in Miracle friendships can fall to the wayside. It helped me to read that in Lesson 76, I am under no laws but God's, where Jesus starts rattling off the laws of economics, you know, the laws of nutrition, and he's going through all these laws, and then he says the laws of friendship are part of the ego. Ooh, that's a friendship? Ooh, that's really interesting, because it's associations. You know how some of our friendships are clearly based in the past. You know, whether it's genetics and DNA, or whether it's high school, the reunions that we went to, or buddies and friends and girls that we've known for all these years. Look what happens on Facebook when you start waking up. You know, you start posting things, you start putting things out, you're all fired up and inspired. Yeah, yeah, ooh, this is good, you're good. And some of those past associations just come and bite you on the rear end. Just like, you know, almost like, no, I don't want to hear that. What are you doing? What's gotten into you? I'm into love and joy. Since when? Who are you, you know? A friend of mine right now is pondering, you know, starting a new Facebook profile, because there's been so many radical shifts that it's almost like, you know, it's almost like wanting to share to the whole world, Ali Ali Income Free, hey, we're all innocent, come on, let's all be innocent, I'll be innocent with you, and then, rah, you know, that's just a doubt thought, showing up as a Facebook message. That has to be one's own doubt thought. It can't be that there's anybody out there that's a doubting Thomas. It has to be, you have to start to see, oh my gosh, I still have a doubt thought. If it's being acted out and I'm reacting to it, then that's something that's a forgiveness lesson. So I feel like it's a joyful opportunity there. And just the symbol that all the miracles you've gone through with your daughter is almost like building the momentum, like, oh, here you go, you've got a lot of joy to extend, and there's no exceptions to that joy, and therefore you do want your whole life, your mind, your space, the reflections around you to all reflect exuberant joy. And otherwise it can start to feel again like a compromise. Like there's a part of your mind going, really? Really? Anger, really? Like, what do I still have any value for anger? You know, there's that part of the mind that's just like, I can't hardly believe I'm still, I have value, anger, what? You know, yeah. So you're just on the cusp, you feel your tethers. It's like those old Thanksgiving parades with the big floats, Macy Day, you know, the little tethers, those little steel cords that hold the big balloons to the gravity of Earth, you know. You've just got your little steel cutters out, and you're just they're ready for the balloons to take off. And if it's just one or two steel cords, you know, and it's blowing in the wind, that can be disturbing, because you know you're just like a snip away from soaring, you know. Snip that cord, you know, whatever it is. Yeah. Yeah, I pray for that, for you, to your joy, your fulfillment, your happiness. Yeah. David.
Well, let's see, I'm going to talk about special relationships. Okay? Turning them into a holy relationship. Well, we've had this special relationship. Next month it'll be 50 years.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's changed a lot from when we first got married. Then, right now, let's see, I'm still very much identified with the body. I still have this body identification. And Christine is way ahead of me. She doesn't have the same bodily identification that I do. And this can cause some problems. You can imagine all kinds of ways. I know that the Course says that the Holy Spirit can use our relationship to turn it into a holy relationship. But right now, I'm dragging my feet. I'm so reluctant. I don't want to give up the things that I like about the physical and, you know, just life as I see it and understand it. And she's not that way. And there's no compromise. And so there's conflict. You know, we do the lesson every day. We do our daily lessons. We read and we go to course meetings on Monday night. And she corrects me all the time. You know. And so I know there's no simple answer. But
all that wisdom in your house is now you're married to Yoda.
It's gonna sound something.
Started off as Christine, now it's wise Yoda.
Yeah.
Which is actually
right. So it's a special relationship problem. Getting beyond that. That's all.
Well, it's interesting, you know, when we sometimes talk about relationships and we identify even characters or characteristics, you know, specialness. And I've been talking a lot about that in this little tour through California, in the sense that I was sharing last night that sometimes people say, well, I've been reading the Course for years and Jesus is telling me about specialness and it's of the ego, so I'm through with special relationships. I'm never going to get in another special relationship, and it would be like a fish thing, I'm through with water. People don't understand the full extent. I mean, the nuances of specialness, just believing that there are separate people even, is specialness. Mm-hmm. The nuances of believing a glass is a glass, a candle is a candle, that's special. I did a talk recently, and somebody was commenting on this YouTube and violence in the media and everything like this, and like how can I deal with all this violence in the media? And I said, thinking an apple is violent. And they were, can you explain that? And again, I've been talking a lot about how when we try to pull apart from the whole, imagine your mind in its quantum or forgiven state just comprehends, beholds the whole as whole. It doesn't try to pull apart a thread out of the tapestry. It doesn't try to pull anything apart. There's some great lessons, like 183, 184, where Jesus describes all these dynamics. You know, how you live by symbols, and you've given everything a name. And he's talking about how its fragmentation is the problem. It's not that any specific symbols are a problem, it's just that the belief that there are specific symbols had it been given meaning, our mind needs to go through the rinse cycle, and that's what the workbook's for. Nothing I see means anything. Okay, rinse, okay, here we go. Just rinse and rinse, rinse me clean, purify my heart, take me back to Christ's vision, to wholeness, to abstraction, take me back into the light. You know, I want to go back to the light. I want to go back to heaven, nirvana. So, in one sense, it's almost like you're seeing something and you're labeling it and then seeing that this happens in relationships where one seems to be reflecting, opening up faster than another. And everybody knows that even about relationships. When you're in long-term relationships and then there's these nuances, it happens a lot where one seems to open up and the other seems to be want to going, maybe even at a different pace. You're opening too, but maybe the pace of your opening is there. And so you need to come back to, okay, it's the Holy Spirit's use of specialness. The ego is the specialness. The ego made the cosmos. The ego made all the images. And so the Holy Spirit has to use it. And that really gets back to guidance. Like, how willing am I to open up to guidance and really connect with the Holy Spirit? Because that's really the core issue. It's not so much a horizontal issue between David and Christine. It's a vertical issue. To the extent that I'm like, whoa, slow it down and hold on there a bit, then that puts, that's the block. Because the Holy Spirit, as I said, wills no delay, would not have the mind linger in time. And so when you start to take it back that way, then it's like, oh yeah, I need to let the resistance rise up in awareness. I need to, whatever fears I have, even the fear of loss or the fear of sacrifice, which it can be if there's things like in the world that still seem valuable, then there's a fear of sacrifice. And that means there's a belief in sacrifice that's underneath there. And the Holy Spirit is wanting to rinse that and wash that. So when I've had, I mean, years ago, I had a student who, she got into A Course in Miracles, and the more she practiced A Course in Miracles, she was into yoga, but the more she practiced the Course, her sex drive started to go away, her libido started to shrink. And her husband wasn't in the Course, and he was more Orthodox Jew, and expectations, you know. And so, they would come right to me. They would just say, we need help here. We got some major conflict going on in our marriage. And so they both loved me and respected me, so I would go and I would sit down with them. And, you know, he was a dentist and Orthodox Jew, and he said, you know, this is my wife, David. You know, this is my sexual partner. And, of course, I have expectations. At least I want to have sex 2 days a week, at minimum, 2 or 3 times a week. And because of my schedule with dentistry, you know, it has to be like Tuesday afternoon and Thursday night. And so, you know, this is great. This is the kind of stuff that I'm like, good. I'm like in the Matrix, like, let's hear it. Give it. It doesn't matter. Say it. Don't censor it at all. There. And he would, you know, there was like 2 or 3 times a week. And when it needed to be and everything, and his wife's just sitting there watching him, you know, during the whole thing. It's like, go have your turn. And then since she comes in and she just goes, listen, you know, I don't know what's going on, but I don't have such a sex drive and this and this. And yes, I know I'm your wife, but, you know, I just don't feel it. I mean, I'm my mind's opening. I'm getting into all kinds of things. And she said, and I value spontaneity. I can't fit into a schedule. Can't have my declining sex drive scheduled into the days of the week, but see, this is what you need to have. This is the kind of talks that people need to have. It's like, good. This is really good. Let's hear it, you know. And she gave the whole thing. So then, after they both had talked, I said, okay, let's just pray on this. And I said, you know, you still feel like a deep love and connection? Yes. Yes, we do. We still feel the love, and you still want to be with. Yes, we still want. We want to be with each other, and this. So then it's like, well, then let's pray and then start talking. And so I think at the end of that session, it was more that she was like saying, you know, can I be spontaneous with this? And he was opening, saying, okay, I see, I need to open here to be more spontaneous. You know, he was seeing, and I'm willing to do that, he said. And again, you know, you just pray and then you let it come out and then you let the chips fall because there's a love underneath. And as I was sharing earlier, there's Judy and Whit, you know, they've been married 38 years, but she was married to Bob prior to that, and I think he had a couple of marriages too, but it's been for a higher purpose. Very dear, watching those two today, and she's called him my honey, and you know, it's just, oh, you know, it's 84 and 87, and it's beautiful, but there has to be an underlying purpose, and that there takes, it's like a self-honesty with it too. I know that's, you know, you're going through that, Christine's going through that. It's like a self-honesty with spirit. Because nobody can go through the motions. We have to be authentic. We can't play games with ourselves. You know, if we start to feel certain things, as things start to shift in our perception, it's important for us to be very transparent about those. The ego is so afraid of loss or so afraid of rejection that the ego wants to keep aspects of the mind very private. And Jesus even told Helen Schuckman and Bill Thetford that they'd both chosen like life partners to avoid intimacy. Mm-hmm. How's that for choosing partners to avoid intimacy? You know, that's quite insightful. But he was saying, no, you picked partners that would be reflections of avoiding reaching that deeper love and deeper intimacy. So you can say, wow, we do share a purpose. We do things together, whether it's listening to the talks that I give or reading the course or sharing miracle inspirations and so on and so forth. And it's more coming back to that focal point, like what is it that we share? What is it that we share that can be expanded instead of coming around from the negative, which is how the ego sees it, like, oh God, Christ, now what am I going to give up next? Christ, you know it's not easy. You know how hard it can be. The way things are going, they're going to crucify me. John Lennon, you know, there you go. I mean, you know, the Beatles could definitely put these emotions into songs that we could relate to. And that's the way it is from the ego's perspective. It just feels like, oh, God, what am I going to have to give up next? Because it just perceives that things are being taken away from it, that it likes, that it enjoys. Actually, it's a rinsing and a washing of the mind, becoming what the mind truly wants. The mind truly wants deep intimacy, deep love, a sense of freedom, a sense of purpose, fulfillment, contentment. Of course the mind wants all of that. That's what we were given in creation. And if we forgot it, we want it back. We want it back. We want that. We want all of it back in our awareness. And that's what's going on. That's the deeper prayer. And then the ego is just perceiving all of that as like a big sacrifice, because it made this world as a substitute for heaven, and then it became very familiar and accustomed. That's the sneakiest of all defenses, when we become familiar with the past, and we think the past is our friend, like a cuddly bear, like a furry, fuzzy creature. I remember an old Jack Jones song. Does anybody ever remember Jack Jones? He was a singer.
Yeah.
He had a song. I've grown accustomed to her face. She almost makes the day begin. You know, it's a real familiar kind of, you know, it's very, all the subtleties of that. That's why people get so bent out of shape when someone dies. They're so accustomed to those conversations. They're accustomed to touch. They're accustomed to being held. That's the hardest part. When we have the death of a sibling or a death of a child or a parent, it's the touch. Oh, I'll never see that face again with that smile. I'll never be able to touch that. I'll never have that embrace again. The ego is going through a time of withdrawal and a time of loss, a grief. That's our word for it. But it's grieving the familiar. And meanwhile, the Christ is right there saying, come, turn your gaze up to me. Your spouse hasn't gone anywhere. Your, whether it's even a cat, a pet, you know, there can be a grief like, no, the cat hasn't gone anywhere, the dog hasn't gone anywhere. I'm here for you. I'm still communicating with you. Communication's unbroken. And so, you know, we're just getting to those subtleties right now. That's what it's really coming down to.
David, at our Unwind Your Mind group last Saturday night, I forget what page it's on, it's 300-some, this person was talking to you about, sometimes I really feel in the spirit, and when I do the lessons and so on, and then other times it's, you know, back in ego. And you used the metaphor of, it's like, the ego's like a train that you want to get on. And I just realized how really apropos that metaphor is, because getting on the ego, it's like comfort, you know, there's no effort involved, you just go that way, you know, you don't have to decide anything, you just go that way, as opposed to if you're going by yourself, you got to make all your own decisions and face everything yourself. So I just wanted to compliment you on your
on that metaphor.
On that metaphor.
The train of comfort.
Yeah, the ego, that's what it is.
Yeah. Yeah, it can seem much less challenging to just hop on the train and sit in the seat and just go, and it's going to go where it goes. Whereas the spontaneity of kind of just being dropped in an area where it's just you there, and what do I do next, and this and this, is scary to the ego, because it has its own definitions of safety and security, and spontaneity is not not one of those definitions. Yeah. Thank you for raising that. Those are all. Those are the subtleties.
Yeah.
You're facing it. Yes.
I have a question. I do this one practice where I'll sit for about 5 minutes or so and just ask myself, is this a dream? Am I dreaming? And I'll just sit there and watch. And most of the time, I get a very clear sense that this is all a dream. It's just it's sort of like a sense of this fuzziness that just sort of, I'm not this body sitting here. I'm just sort of behind me, just sort of watching this whole thing. And so I've gotten more clear that this whole, everything is a dream. And yet I'm not sure how to proceed with this or what. It's not scary or anything, but just not sure what to do with this.
Yeah, it sounds like quite an interesting practice. Because it's like if you can feel that with a lot of seeming situations, and then it's more like that lighthouse thing I was talking about, letting it sweep, that can be like almost like a mantra, that from time to time you just, it's almost like checking in and what's on the screen here, is this a dream? Because there's lots of movies that are part of my Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment that's a common thing of really being able, how can I discern that it's a dream? Or even how can I remember, if I become aware of the idea that it's a dream, how can I stay consistently aware that I'm dreaming? In Inception, they had these little kind of totems. The little totem, that's how the movie ends, you know, is the totem is spinning, which I thought was a spectacular ending to the movie. Like, even after they seem to come to this place of freedom and they all looking into each other's eyes at the airport in this sense of recognition, welcome home, Mr. Cobb, and all this and this, then I loved it that the totem was spinning at the end, because it was like, and even the happy dream is still a dream. But even it's just been purified of its hatred, purified of its competition and guilt, and it's still a dream. So There's another movie that's a great movie called Waking Life, like an animated one, and that's a theme in the movie, is like, how do I remember, how am I aware that I'm dreaming? There's little signs and clues. And this is an important issue, because there's one part of A Course in Miracles where Jesus actually comes straight out and says it, that awareness of dreaming is the function of God's teachers. He actually comes straight out and says it. You know, a lot of times it's forgiveness and atonement and miracle, but he comes right out and says awareness of dreaming is the function of God's teachers. So I think it's a really good practice. And then especially if you start to feel your heart beating, or there's a situation that seems to have some intense emotion with it, that's almost the perfect time to insert the question, am I dreaming?
I find it a lot easier to do it while I'm doing this practice than other situations during the day.
Yeah. I'd say there's a really spectacular movie. There's a trilogy, just so you know about the Matrix trilogy and this and this. There's the Divergent series. And the second one, the first one, we start to see the main character, you know, into some pretty extreme conditions where she's being tested for fear. And the way she gets out of it, and nobody can understand how she can get out of the seeming fearful situation so quickly, but she just gets into a glass container that she can't get out of, or she's sinking into some mud or something, and the birds are attacking her and so on and so forth. It's, this isn't real, which is another version of I'm only dreaming. And then no one else, they're all pondering in the beginning, Divergent. And then, of course, that will come up when she has to face her fears in the second of the series. And then, of course, this coming March, we get to see the third in the series. But it's an amazing series for teaching that very thing that you're talking about. Yes?
I've been reading Unwind Your Mind with the group. And I was raised Christian, and we were taught to push down your emotions, push everything down, look good. And so what I really appreciate about your book is that you say, you know, when the emotions come up, don't push them down, allow them to come up.
Yeah.
And some difficult emotions have been coming up. And the strongest one that seems to not be letting up is real self-hatred, like real self-hatred, and a hardness. Like, I feel a real hardness towards myself. I find that I'm not taking good care of myself sometimes, when I can take much better care of other people than I do myself. And I know that underneath all that is this intense self-hatred. And it seems to be more apparent. And it's been around for a long time now. And I'm just sort of wondering if you have any ideas about that, because I sort of want this one to kind of pass. And it's not. It's not.
Mm.
It's a relief to let the emotions come up and to allow them to be. It is a huge relief rather than judging it, pushing it down. But this is pretty challenging. And I don't really want to be around other people very much. I'm almost, I don't know, there's a way in which I'm almost a recluse right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's challenging.
Hmm. Well, it's interesting. Yeah, when you were just sharing, it's interesting. You know what? You grow up and you, in this society, you watch all this TV. We're in the TV generation, and all the commercials, thousands that I've watched. And as you're talking, I've got the jingle from an ancient commercial going into my mind, which I don't know, could be turned into a ringtone or something on your phone. Be good to yourself. It's important to do. So be good to yourself. There's only one you. And it was playing in my mind when you're asking the question. Oh, that's cute. I mean, I never, especially the ending. There's only one you. Oh my God, that's so metaphysical. But that's the lightness of the spirit. You know, imagine turning that into a ringtone so that every time someone calls you, there's this. You're being serenaded. There's only one you. Be good to yourself. You know, we have to start to turn the tables on the ego. We need to be playful. We need to have reminders. Mm. I had one friend from England who was such a high state of mind, and one point when she went back to her mobile home where she lived, her trailer, she started getting these like post-it notes, the little post-it notes, and there was one phase she went through where she just put one word all over her stove, her counter, I mean, it was just stuck all over the place, post-it notes, aware. Mm. Just reminding her, mm-hmm. like in her own word, to stay aware. Stay aware, don't sleepwalk, don't push things down, stay aware. I think I just recently showed a mini movie down in Topanga Canyon. I showed the mini movie of 50 First Dates, mm-hmm. where Drew Barrymore has a memory problem from an accident of seemingly hitting a tree in a vehicle and having brain damage and so on and so forth. And Adam Sandler plays the guy who sees her in the little breakfast shack and starts to fall in love with her. And then is told by her father, you know, that she has this condition. She's actually told that by the lady that works at the breakfast shack. And he first can't believe it. He says, what do you mean? She's got a memory condition? This is some kind of a crazy story that I tell women to throw them off, to get rid of them. And you're telling me this is the truth. But eventually he ends up making a video that kind of reminds her of the accident, brings it all back. It was pushed out of awareness, brings it back into awareness, including the context of those around her, her brother, her father, himself, others that love her. Mm-hmm. It's part of a retraining of the mind. I loved that he made a video for her to reorient her mind. Mm-hmm. And the course is, that's what the mind training of the course is, really reorienting the mind. But we need to allow ourselves to be flowing and creative to bring aspects and things from the world, symbols, into our life that will help us during those times of self-hatred, self-doubt, fear coming up. We need tools. We need reminders. We need consistent reminders. Mm-hmm. My prayer to the Holy Spirit was always, you know, just flood my mind with reminders of love and light. Mm-hmm. Like this is a big turn. And Jesus does say, in the Course, and still you get in touch with the extent of your own self-hatred, you will not be willing to let it go. That's what's happening. You're just getting in touch with the full extent of self-hatred. It's probably one of the most unpleasant periods of the awakening process. Defenses, self-criticisms that were kind of pushed out of awareness and the mind was into distracting, like you said, appearances, distracting. Now, when you first let them up into awareness, the judgment, the self-criticism is enormous. Like, I can't believe I'm doing this to myself. Or over time, I can't believe I've done this to myself for so many years. You know, the ego just wants the mind to wallow and get stuck into self-judgment and criticism. When really, these are just defense mechanisms that have been unconscious that are now becoming conscious. And that's the first step in letting them go, is letting them into awareness. So you're actually benefiting and gaining.
So the ego's actually using all of this new knowledge.
Yes. It's hijacking the new knowledge to build a case against you. To build a case for guilt, to build a case for pain, almost to build a case for punishment, which is sponsoring that idea.
Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's okay. Where you have to start to say, I'm on to you here. I see that you're trying to take everything that I'm going through and just use it as fuel.
Against me.
Against you. Fuel to keep you trapped instead of to free you and release you. And initially, Drew Barrymore, when she was first told about what happened, you know, the father and the brother were doing protectionism to the max, you know, painting the wall and giving her colored paints to paint new things. Fake newspaper of the same day. They were doing the Groundhog Day thing, except they were doing it to her because they didn't think she could handle what was underneath
the truth
of it, and therefore they were doing it to themselves. They were adapting to her problem and watching the same football game on videotape over and over, the Minnesota Vikings, the same scenes, watching the same movie, that movie, what was the one?
Sixth Sense,
over and over and over, where she's like, I was so surprised. It's a ghost in there. Yeah. You know, it's like, imagine watching the same movie over and over and over, painting the same wall white over the colors, filling the soap and you know, pineapple, frozen, a whole case of frozen pineapples, and it's a lot of work. My gosh, the maintenance that we do when we adapt to illusions. And that's the same kind of people-pleasing that everyone knows goes on in relationships. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, honey, I don't want to rock the boat, and what can I do for you, and this, and this, and this. And then the pattern just goes on and on and on and on, and then a resentment starts to build up. Like, okay, maybe like you start off, okay, I'll give you foot rubs, and then foot rubs, and then after a while, I don't like foot rubs. And you start to feel resentful for something, the very thought of it, the socks come off, oh God, again, I have to, you know, these are these rituals that human beings get into, and what's the contrary to the ritual? Well, oh my God, they could just say, get out, you're not going to give me foot rubs anymore, you have no use to me, out the door, you know. And it can be the same, we know, it can be the same with sexuality, it can be the same with anything. One in the partner is the breadwinner. Bring home the bread, bring home the money, and then it comes to a point, you know, I don't want to work anymore. I don't want to, what? That's your role. I spend the money, you earn the money. What do you mean? You're not going to, nope, I'm cashing in my chips, I'm quitting my job and everything. What? What about our lifestyle? Oh, I don't want to work anymore. You work. Ah! God! Don't say that word. Work. Me. No, I don't. I spend the money. You earn the money. I spend. You know, it's just these roles get so set, and then there's a certain, that's what Sundari's going through with David at her home, you know, is you're the mom, he's playing the son, you've got the money, he doesn't. You've got the house, he doesn't. You say, it's my house, it's my way or the highway. He goes, So you play like the ogre, and he plays the victim. And then at some point it's like, we got to shake this up. You know, it's like, this is, we got to do it. You know, even for one day if you switched, you should try it out. Where he says, and by the way, get me this and do this and this. And then, here, take my shoes off for me. And for one day. And you know, like thinking, please switch it back, you know. But though we have movies, that's what, you know, like Eddie Murphy, Trading Places, then. Yeah. But there's these unholy alliances that are, what are the unholy alliances built out of expectations? Oh, they're like caked in with expectations. And heaven forbid you violate the expectation. Then there's a war going to go on. like, you know. And I mean, I've just met so many people and so many families, and I guess the spirit kind of uses me as a activator of, like, let's get underneath this to the hurt and the pain that's underneath of reenacting these rituals, you know, to keep the status quo. I used that in one of my talks, and then Nikita was like, she called me up, status quo, I heard you say status quo. I'm having a... That was like the words that triggered something for you, right? You had something. You knew there was something. It was not so much.
The time has come because I've been hearing for quite a while. Like, you can't keep the status quo and be happy. Like, you can't. And I'm like, it's almost like intellectually, I don't know what status quo is. And it's like, I'm like, okay. And then I try to Google it, but I couldn't, for the love of God, I couldn't put two and two together. But it's like, status quo. And then I was like, where? What? Like, so it was like, almost kind of like a bit of outside search. It's like, where is this? Who's got status quo? and then all of a sudden, like, so that went on for a while. And then all of a sudden, we're on the call. And David, all of a sudden, it comes out of him, like, status quo. Like, do we want to keep it? And I was like, uh-oh, there's that mysterious status quo. And then again, like, so next two nights, I spent sleepless nights, and it was like, and I was like, keep status quo, you know, maybe it's helpful. Hey, I was like, well, maybe something that can be used, and it's actually helpful. What do I know anymore? And then it just, and then at some point it was almost like a breakdown. It was like, I have no choice. I've been hearing for 2 years, or like, I don't know how long it's been, almost like 2 years, like, have to let go of status quo. And it's like, it's not a choice. It's like, it's almost spirit. It was like, you tell me, do you think you can actually keep it? And I was at a point where I can't, like, I just can't, like, I'm at the end of the rope. And so I called David. I was like, what is this status quo? And then they were like, I can't, I have to let it go, but I don't even know what it is. And let alone how to let it go. And so, but I know there's something that is not helpful, and it's like, I can't, like, it has to go. It has to go, and there is some fear that it's like, it has to be harsh. And so I'm like, but I have no choice. So David explained, took his time and explained it to me in understandable terms what it is. And it was like, well, then, yeah. It's definitely something.
Yeah. Yeah, letting go of the familiar.
Yeah.
Because the familiar, you know, to the ego is, it's pushed the definition of comfort and security. That to the ego, the status quo, whatever it seems to be, which is a set of concepts and a set of perceptions, you know, that is comfortable and familiar and secure and safe. And then in the ego's perception, the Holy Spirit is very scary, because that is something that was going to shine away the status quo. It's going to shine away the past. It's going to shine away the familiar. And it seems like all of us, sooner or later, we start to get an idea like, oh my gosh, this is not a course in miracles of learning anything. This is a course in unlearning. Whatever we were doing before, thinking we're making progress, and we're going to achieve future enlightenment, and we're going to get more spiritual, and take more spiritual courses, and more spiritual workshops, and just keep building and building and building, like the Tower of Babel, almost like make our way back to God through all these achievements and concepts. And then, oh my gosh, at some point it starts to dawn, though, it's everything's being washed away. Like Whit was talking about today, that Alzheimer's state that his dear friend was in, of not knowing, you know, not having the words, not being able to put together sentences, not being able to have a conversation, a normal conversation, because he could only string a few words together. Voice of God. Course, voice of God at the end, and City of God in his sandbox, you know, those are the words he could string together, and he couldn't coherently put anything else together. He was so letting go of the status quo and coming back to that place of innocence, original innocence. Before guilt was, I am, innocence is. Wow, before guilt was, innocence is. Wow, that's undoing time. So Jesus tells us time goes backwards, not forwards. What a trick. We've always believed that time was going forward. And we look forward ambitions and future goals and future achievements and future accomplishments. And the whole thing underneath it was, no, time's going backwards. We get it in science. You know, you look at science and there's amazing concepts in science. The concept of entropy. Entropy. The whole cosmos is moving to chaos. Oh my God, science was trying to tell us something. If the whole cosmos is moving to chaos, then I want to go the other direction of the whole cosmos. And if that movement of forward moving, bigger, better, more, faster, better, new, improved, you know, if all that is not it, if all that is the status quo, then it's glory, hallelujah, to start to say, okay, I surrender. Ollie, Ollie, income free. Here's my white flag. I'm not going to play the ego's game anymore. It takes trust. It takes trust to let go of the status quo. It takes trust to let go of the familiar. That's what these last 25 years have been for me. I had 10 years of university. I had degrees. I had the beginnings of a career. Oh, then Jesus, at like 28 years old, he tells me, you won't have a career. Is that the kind of thing you tell somebody when they're 28 years old? Why don't you tell them when they're 5 or something, you know? But not when you're 28, because that's the time when you're supposed to, what? Be building a career. He said, you won't have a career in this lifetime. Well, we'll see how that goes. That's going to be interesting. Talk about trust. Well, that's going to be a... How am I supposed to get money? You know, yeah, I'll take care of that. Relationship, I'll take care of that. It takes a lot of faith to let go of that forward, that momentum to try to move to make yourself better. I mean, if you go to the library or you go to the bookstore, there's the self-help section is pretty big. You know, we've spent a lot of time in the self-help section. The only thing is, we never took time to question, who is the self that needs help? Does our spirit, does our spiritual reality and being need help? No, it doesn't. It's the ego that wants to keep improving to become a better and better ego and a spiritual ego. It wants to be a spiritual ego. And then if it becomes a good, new, improved spiritual ego to the point, then it will reach a point of arriving. Even that's a trick. That's more status quo. I saw your hand up in the back. Yes.
So we embrace the ego as this plan that's in our way that is doesn't serve us. Why are we constructed that way? Why would ego be so prominent and such a challenge to us?
Well, I would say that, number one, it's a death wish. So if you take a powerful mind and you invest your powerful mind, your faith, your trust, your power, your glory in a death wish, well, the results are depressing, shocking, hard, fearful. Well, we aren't. That's the beautiful thing. You know, the ego doesn't exist, I'll tell you right away. And the only way you experience its nothingness is by being tapped into God. If everything you think and say and do is inspired by the Spirit, if you're not only here to heal and bless, to radiate, to shine joy, 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 joy. Where's the ego in that? There is no ego. There's no ego. And that's the most beautiful thing, is that we are naturally happy. We don't. Why would we want to experience heaven or nirvana if it's pure bliss and joy? What would be our resistance to that, except maybe we still believe that there's something substitute, something not real, something temporary that has value. So a basic question comes down to, am I going to value the temporary or am I going to value the eternal? Well, I'll tell you, for me, it's no choice. There's no choice in that at all. That's so obvious. I'd say I had to be quite convinced, you know.
The question though, why is society, why is our pattern, why is there thousands and thousands of years of patterns in which we have to resist, learn, unlearn? Why is there so much unlearning we need to do?
But
it seems like this is natural, we should be able to gravitate.
Yes.
The world should all
operate
in this way with ease.
Yes. That's my experience now, is that it's, you know, resistance is futile, as the Borg teach, and that there is nothing reasonable about fear or doubt or hatred. It in the end, you can start to see that there's no point. And when I've talked for hours and hours for the last 25 years, some people will actually come up to me and say, you know what, David, if I totally lined up with what you're thinking, and the whole world lined up with what you're thinking, the world would cease to exist. And I said, that's absolutely correct.
My question is, why doesn't that happen?
Well, who said it didn't? Who said it doesn't? I'm not a proponent of time. I'm not even a proponent of process. I'm just sharing that happiness is the most natural condition there ever could be. It's so natural. And at some point, it seemed like I had to flip over from this dirge I was singing. Why is it so hard, hard, hard? Why is everything so hard? Wait a minute, this is unnatural. I was like saying the same things, and then at some point it flipped, where I'm like, oh, hallelujah. It's easier to be happy. It's easier to be happy. It's easier to be joyful. It's natural to be joyful. That's like a natural state of mind. It is. It's very natural. So then the questions disappear. The questions get dissolved in the light. Because I went from questioning, and question everything, and lots of questioning. And then I came to a point where the Spirit was saying, well, you've got helpful questions and unhelpful questions. Okay. Tell me the difference then, if I'm doing all this questioning, and there's helpful questions and unhelpful questions. What are the helpful questions? He said, the helpful questions are those that are questioning the very existence of consciousness, the very existence of error. The helpful questions take you inward. Like, what am I believing here? What am I perceiving here? The unhelpful questions are questions about the form. Why do bad things happen to good people? Jesus is like, you'll never get the answer to that question. That's not really a question. That's just a statement disguised as a question. Oh, it is. And then he said, most of the questions in all the disciplines of this world, if you go to college, all the questions of the causes and effects in chemistry and physics, and you name it. Even in cooking food, there's cause and effect relationships. How long do you leave the cherry pie in the oven? So the crust is nice and golden brown and everything? No. All those questions presume an external world. Presume a world of causes and effects. And all of our disciplines in our universities all have faulty, spurious cause-effect relationships. Every single discipline in there. Now there's quantum physics, which I would say is coming we're coming to an end of that belief in causes and effects, because we're starting to see there's no world outside the thinker. There's no world apart from consciousness. Now we actually, our science and our mysticism are coming to the same point. We're waking up. We're going, oh my God, this, I had been fooled. I once was lost, but now I see. Oh my gosh, amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Hallelujah. Get a rose for that one. My God, this is wonderful. And yet, it's dissolving everything. It's dissolving the whole world. The whole world is dissolving now. I would say it has dissolved. Ha, that's the fun part. It's over. It's over. Yes?
You mentioned consciousness just before, and there's a line in the Course, and I know I'm paraphrasing it, or maybe I have it slightly wrong, but it says something to the effect of consciousness is the last error that needs to be corrected. And I wonder if you could explain that, because I never could understand. I thought everything was consciousness.
Yeah, I know when you read a lot of non-duality stuff and watch a lot of non-dualities, you know, there's a lot of words that get used. People even use the word Christ consciousness, but actually Christ doesn't have a consciousness. You know, it's great to have the Course because you have an awakened master. I mean a real awakened master, not a teacher who's saying he's awake. But I mean there's an awake master, and he's saying consciousness arose after the separation. Okay. Now, I love it. Give it to me straight. So there's no such thing as Christ consciousness. Woo, that's getting in there. Now we're getting good. Because if consciousness arose after the separation, and Christ is the I am-ness before time was, before Abraham was I am, he was teaching that. I and the Father are one, he was teaching spirit. Then that means that consciousness is the first split that's introduced in the mind. How can we know that consciousness is not real? Well, it has levels. Everybody remember the 60s? What was the goal in the 60s? Raise your what? Raise your level of consciousness. And if consciousness has levels, it ain't real. Why? Because spirit doesn't have any levels. How many levels are there in oneness? One is one is one. Not three, not four, not seven. One, one, one. Is that simple? Whew! That is simple. The truth is one. The truth is love, unconditional love. The truth is spirit, and consciousness was the first split that was introduced. So, if that's the case, then why would consciousness be the last thing that needs to be corrected? It's because fragmentation was what consciousness was about. But what happens when consciousness becomes unified? What happens when we reach what the quantum physics call, the physicists call the unified field? What? The unified field? I think I heard about the field from Rumi, the great poet and mystic. There is a field. I will meet you there. Whoa! Rumi was talking about the quantum field long before the physicists even came up with the word. Rumi was right in there. You know, these are... Why does Rumi resonate with everybody? Because it's reflecting the truth. So that's why it's the last one to be corrected, because the belief that anything could be fragmented ever is the introduction of error. And unified awareness is really what Jesus calls the happy dream. Why is it so happy? Because it's unified, it's whole. There's no separate parts to it. Even these things that, you know, we talk about, you know, that the parts contain the whole. No, they don't. No, they don't.
So I'm not clear on something. I'm looking at what's going on in the quote world, especially politically.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm sitting, first of all, aside from, and I realize this is my own perception, my own projection. I'm looking at this and saying, this is crazy. Okay. But then I'm seeing that where people are is based on their level of consciousness, which is good prediction. But I'm having trouble getting beyond that. Now I get it with the consciousness is the first split after the separation. I'm still having a little trouble saying that people who would, and it's just my projection, people who would vote for a certain person or some these people here know my beliefs. Okay.
Yeah.
This
is great. I love these questions. This is great. These are the most practical questions ever. I love it. Get into politics. That's good with me. I think it's fantastic.
Could you share? Oh, yes, I can share.
Oh, yeah. This is good. Well, you know, everything is a concept. Everything's just an idea. So when we talk about politics, you know, that's the concept of politics. And you can't really even have the concept of politics without the concept of duality. Imagine if you had no parties. If you took the parties out of politics, if you took the sides out of politics, if you took the people out of politics, whoo, that's cool. Buddha would love it. Empty the mind. Just take the politics and just suck at the vacuum out. I got a few. I still believe in people. Sides, parties, liberal, conservative, independent. You could do that with anything. Sexuality. If you took the parts out of sexuality, if you took the private parts out of sexuality. I should be a stand-up comedian. I think I got the wrong profession. If you took the private parts out of sexuality, wow. And isn't that the way that it goes? I mean, Christine knows she's heading in that direction, and David's going, oh, hell, this is not good at all. Let's look at the course, you know. Bill Thedford, he was the one who calmed Helen and typed it out from the shorthand and this and this and this. You know, I think when Bill, from everything I know about Bill, when he was younger, he was identified as heterosexual when he was younger because there was a woman that he really was after and wanted to be in a relationship with, and I found out from talking to Judy that eventually that was part of his healing lesson. It was like unrequited love. He loved this woman. She didn't seem to love him, and by the end of his life, he called her up. They went, spent some time together at a hotel, and he totally forgave. He forgave all his relationships. I mean, every last one of them, and he laid aside the body, left it in the sunshine up here in the Bay Area, just laying in the grass. And he was heterosexual. Then he went through a homosexual phase. And then when I talked to Carol Howe, good friend of his, and Judy and this, they said, well, actually, by the end of his life, he was asexual. It's almost predictable. Because what? Spirit is asexual. Spirit's non-sexual. Spirit doesn't have a body. It's kind of hard to have sex without a body. Just one spirit, you know. Hey, you know, you can't do the hey baby thing. There's no baby. There's no baby. Hey, I like your hair and I like your curves. No, there's no curves. There's no hair. There's no breasts. There's no private parts. And imagine now we'll apply it to politics, you know. If you suck all the concepts out of politics, what do you got left? Oneness. Absolute oneness. You could do it with food and nutrition. I have so much fun with that, you know. I was just in Southern California, and I was with a group of young, wonderful people. Nikita's with me, and we're going through there. That was the most organic. I mean, this was like a showcase. A showcase. We went in there, and we went in the refrigerator and everything, and I looked, is there any cow's milk in there? No, there wasn't any cow's milk. They had to bring in cow's milk for me because it was almond and, you know, oh my gosh. If this was on a scale of 1 to 10, this was 11. It was an 11 in there. And then Nikita's like, you got any candy? And they were like, you know. They didn't have a drop of candy in that house. Sugar? No, there's other substitutes. Health? No. You know, it was just amazing. And then finally we went out, a holy encounter. We went down to the pier at Malibu and this. We finally stopped off at one of the things, and I just bought a Halloween size Snickers bar. You know, with all the little things. I've got to get some Snickers into this house and everything. Just for teaching purposes. For teaching purposes. And they loved them. As soon as I took a bite of the Snickers bar, they loved me. My God, you wouldn't believe it. They were eating. Well, tell them. There was Snickers.
They were eating pancakes with Snickers, and then
they
were like, this is the best meal of our lives. Baking meal. They forgot.
And with vegetarianism, it was a duplex. After my first day of talks, Krista went downstairs and roasted. They roasted a lamb. Now, what I'm saying is, the guilt's in the mind. The guilt's not in the food, and the guilt's, you know, not. And now this is a lot of unlearning. But we're doing it with politics and sex. We might as well go after food too tonight. My God, you should be enlightened before you get back to your house tonight.
The funny thing is, it's like it was so deep because there we were like kind of like because they're so interesting and they wanted to talk about metaphysics and quantum drama, like quantum movies, me and Mr. Nobody.
It's great.
Like how about it? And then David was like, well, you know, just very gently, almost casual. He was like, you know, like quantum and this, like the dad goes, it's like you have to look like at concepts. For instance, nutrition. And it's like one goes like, oh. And then friendship, oh. And it was like already was so like, oh, like concepts were like threatened. But then at the end, he was kind of like, they were eating Snickers.
They were adorable.
And it was like something
they were so adorable.
It was all of a sudden it wasn't all so scary, but like from the beginning, it was like, oh, it almost like you pushed it, you just pushed it a little too far, right? So kind of like, so it took a whole weekend of deep sessions, and then in the end, it's like, oh, eating like drinking milk, eating lamb, Snicker bar, like Snicker bar.
We're in love. We were falling in love.
And letting the cat teach the little puppy, not protecting the puppy from the cat, because like a puppy was going after the cat, and the cat just wasn't impressed. He kept going after it, and they were like, you know what, I think the puppy just needs to learn its lesson, you know? And they were just like not protecting it, and in the end, the cat got the puppy, and it just went like, and like, now she knows her lesson. You know, it's just like, these are like little things.
Yeah, they're
so
huge.
Deep.
They're very little, but they're actually huge.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's an amazing awakening, and we're all falling into this, you could say fallen or arising to this amazing love that's beyond judgments, that's beyond trying to point the finger, and it's actually goes beyond preferences. It's just absolutely amazing, and the spirit is so gentle that the spirit uses everything that's believed in just to lift the mind, to purify consciousness, to lift it higher and higher and higher and higher into these glorious states of mind where, you know, you do start to question everything. Because the problem is not in the form, it's the problem is in this faulty perception. This fragmented perception is the problem. The problem's not meat or non-meat. The problem's not lactose or non-lactose. The problem's not in this configuration. You know, people make all these things about homosexuality versus heterosexuality and what's more natural and what's more God-given. God didn't create this cosmos. There's nothing that comes from God that has anything to do with time and space. God is eternal. There's nothing eternal in time and space. The black holes aren't eternal. The stars will go out. We now know they're burning gases. Our romantic songs were quite, you know, I will love you until the stars no longer shine. It's like, no, they're just burning gases. As long as the stars shine in the heavens above, I will love you. Nowadays, people are sophisticated. Is that all? You've got a time limit on you'll love me for... till the guests, till the lights go out. I'm going for a better offer. Jesus Christ has got a better offer for me than that. I'll fall in love with Jesus instead of you. Forget the roses. You better come up with better than until the stars no longer shine in heaven. You know, it's, you know, we will only be content with eternity. Time and eternity cannot coexist. Why? Because one is not real and one is. Reality and unreality don't go together. What happens when you bring the darkness to the light? The darkness disappears. What happens when you bring ignorance to wisdom? The ignorance disappears. So that's what we should be focusing on. When we're looking at political candidates and we're weighing where they are on the spectrum, are liberal, conservative, help the economy, you know, help bring about peace and security by building walls and fences and more weapons. Well, just more defense spending, you know. When Jesus said meekness, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth, he said nothing about building defenses. I loved it with Michael Moore's movie, Capitalism, A Love Story. I was showing Michael Moore's movie, Capitalism, A Love Story, down one time in a big tent, a big wedding tent in Australia. And the commentary of the Holy Spirit put together with Michael Moore's movie, the ego was furious. It was shaking the tent. It was trying to blow the whole tent down, knock the screen over, because I was basically, with the Spirit's help, dismantling capitalism. And of course, I could do the same with socialism and communism and all the other isms. And in the end, mysticism. You know, that's a nice inroad, but then again, that can go too. Why not? If everything is one, we don't need any isms. You know, that's the beautiful thing of this. It's so free, it's so happy, it's so joyful. It's so still, it's so quiet, it's so natural. And so I find it very helpful. Those are, the election thing is offering lots of opportunities for forgiveness. Lots of opportunities. I'm glad you brought that question up, because that's the kind of questions we need to get into. We need to get into the practicality of whatever's stirring something up. You know. Any of the political candidates, I would just adore meeting them all. Of course, I said the same about Osama bin Laden, Saddam Hussein. I think I was going around the country years ago saying, Osama, everyone's, where's Osama, where's Osama? I said, I hope I find him and meet him for lunch. We can have some good Persian food and really enjoy a holy encounter. And they're like, oh. And somebody said, he's probably hiding close to the Bush Ranch. They were trying to tell me where I could go. Go to Texas to find him. Because he was so well hidden, they thought he must be next to the Bush Ranch. Where's your opponent? The last place you would look. That's from Revolver, the movie, Guy Ritchie's movie. Yes. Oh, you've been ready to go.
Okay. I'd like to ask another question about the, you know, the stuck relationship between a parent and an adult child.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as the, you know, this young adult now starts to, you know, just spread their wings and try to find out who they are, and now they're crossing a lot of boundaries that had existed in the family relationship before. But now you're at a point where, for a variety of reasons, there's a lot of anger and there's no heart-to-heart taking place or that is possible to take place. Where does this go next?
Yeah, I did this video one time. I've got like over 1,500 YouTube videos up there now and 5 million plus viewers, and it just keeps spreading and growing. But I love, they come up with titles for my videos, but there was one YouTube video I keep discovering too for myself. I'm like, oh, look at this one. And, oh, I like the title. The title of the one, I would write this down because you probably can find it on YouTube, but it's, the title of it is who's your daddy? Isn't that a nice title for a video? Who's your daddy? Of course, I'm giving the emphasis with the dialect and everything here. But who's your daddy? Who's your parent? That's what all of us really have to ask, because we actually do have a divine parent. Not two. We come from one parent. And the lie of this world, which, you know, Jesus was addressing 2,000 years ago. Who is my father, mother, sister, brother? He that does the will of my Father in heaven is my father, mother, sister, brother. Oh my God, he was teaching this 2,000 years ago, and now he's really teaching it. He's saying, you are a divine offspring from a divine parent, God. Even these religions that talk about mother, father, God, and they say, let's stop anthropomorphizing the one. Let's stop with this masculine and feminine stuff and this male-female stuff. One is one, is one. We're not talking duality here. We're not talking multiplicity here. God is one. That's a core idea. And if God is one and God is spirit and the creator is one, then the creation is like the creator. Because it says in the Bible at the beginning, God created you in his likeness and image. And remember that that you probably remember Gilda Radner and Saturday Night Live, the old Saturday Night Live. There was Father Guido Sarducci. And he was a cool guy. I just saw him on Facebook. And he said, if God created man in his likeness and image, why aren't we all invisible? Says Father Guido Sarducci. And I'm like, he's got it. I should call him up and I say, we are invisible. These images aren't who we are. These are like masks. These are all part of the mask. We're one being coming from one creator. We're spirit. Spirit's invisible to the human eye. And we have to open to spiritual vision. Above all else, I'm determined to see. You know, he's talking about spiritual vision. So to me, that's the thing. So you're asking like a great question, because that's the core question. Underneath the question that Sundari raised earlier, and you're raising again, is a question of authorship. Is God my author? And if God is my author, then I must be like the author, because the author authors in the same likeness and image, which is spirit, we'll say. It have a like quality. Spirit creates spirit. Just like in the Bible, in the Old Testament, begat. That was all physical. So-and-so begat so-and-so, and Adam and Eve, and then you got the whole lineage, and before you know it, you got 7 billion people, the whole human race. Well, spirit creates spirit. And the whole cosmos is really a question of authorship. It's saying, no, I don't think that God is my author. It's saying, I think I have the ability to author myself. And what that turns into is a projection of error into form. So if you ask people, where did you originate? Where are you from? Most of the time they lie and they say some city or some place in time and space. I was born in this country or that country at such and such a time. That's part of the lie. Because that's as if you have earth parents and you were born in some coordinate in time and space. That's the biggest lie there could be. You're an eternal being. Like 2,000 years ago, Jesus walks into a bar. Where are you from? Heaven. Who's your parents? God. When were you born? I'm eternal. Well, what about the world? I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Are you sure? Yes, let the dead bury the dead. My God, he was telling the truth. He actually was telling the truth. But the human beings, where are you from?
Quebec City. Whatever.
Yeah, whatever. Fill in the blank. Time and space.
We're
tell me about your family. Well, I was raised in a Jewish family, and da, 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 da. We descended from here, and we came over from Poland. Da, da, da. Lies. All lies. Human lies. You know, because what? You can't be an eternal being and be a being of time and space. Why? Because they're not real. They're not the same. One is eternal spirit, and one is flesh. It's molecules, atoms. Mostly space, we know. It's like a mirage. This is a mirage. It just looks solid. It's really, we know now there's nothing to it. And even within time, Deepak has told us we're replenishing. We're not the same as we were years ago. It's all new, except it looks the same. It looks like the status quo. It looks familiar, but it's even that's just a mirage. So now we're just starting to realize we can tune into that divine presence, and we don't have to buy into the mirage anymore. We're just shifting our focus from the lie back to the truth. We talked about consciousness before, too, that consciousness arose after the separation. Guess what one of the first things that was invented as far as abilities? Memory. Memory is an ego invention. Why is memory an ego invention? Because it's recalling. And in heaven, there's no recalling. If everything just is, what do you need a recall for? If everything just is present. So memory was invented by the ego, along with consciousness, and now the ego has associated memory with the past. Human beings associate memory with the past. There's a problem with that, because Jesus says in the Course, you can also use memory to remember the present. Oh, that's good news. That means the Holy Spirit can use a skill that the ego invented, an attribute, for the awakening. You can actually use memory to remember the holy instant. That's good news too. So anything the ego made, the Holy Spirit can take over and use it to take you back to eternity. And that's the good news. And it's actually quite comical. That's why I might have a career as a stand-up comedian, a sit-down comedian. I come out to the Bay Area to start a new vocation as a sit-down comedian. Flowers. You can't see that on the recording. Yes.
I have a question about afterlife. Is there anything written in relation to the Course of Miracles about after we die?
Well,
not that I'm concerned about it, but you know, it kind of perspective on how I am processing now.
Well, the best answer for that, to the question, is there an afterlife, or what does the Course say about the afterlife? I always tell this story. It's such a funny parable from the parable of David. I remember I was doing the dishes one time, and I was listening to Ken Wapnick talking on the Course and everything, and I was doing the dishes, and I was listening to my tape, and somebody asked Ken in one of his workshops, and this leads into your question, said, Ken, what does the Course say about life on other planets? And Ken's answer was, the Course says there's no life on this planet. I was like, oh my God, that's good. So if there's no life on this planet, then of course there would be no afterlife either. If there's no life, or people, I would go around to a lot of churches and share the Course and everything, and most of the times I got invited into Unity churches and everything. So I would be in Unity churches and I'd be talking to people, but nobody in Unity churches was ever talking about death. I never heard anything about death in a Unity church. It was always transition. You know, it's like, oh, so-and-so made their transition and transition, transition. And so I went to one church and I said, this is great, I'm in Unity. Nobody ever dies. In this church, it's so great. They just make their transitions. But I just have one small question. Transition to what? If this is unity, how many sides are there in unity? And that's the thing with life, that life is eternal. So what we have defined, I mean, we, meaning the ego, has defined as biological life and between birth and death and everything, the ego is quite clever. It's invented its own version of life. And it's quite convincing, and it tries to convince the sleeping mind that the body actually has life. And that life begins at birth and or conception, whatever, however you want to define it, and ends at death. So actually, that was Ken's really hit it right on, hit the nail on the head. There's no life on this planet. There's no life in this cosmos, and there's no afterlife either. Those are concepts. Now, the spirit will use the concepts to reach the mind with what it believes. So that's the way it's been in my life a lot of times. Like, I went to Roscoe, where Ken used to be with Gloria up there in Roscoe, New York, and as soon as I got there, I had all these people coming out of the woodwork that wanted to meet me, talk to me and everything. And yeah, one of the women that contacted me first, her husband had just passed, and she just was concerned about him, like, is he okay? And she wanted to ask me all these things, and she said, I saw you in a dream, and spirits had talked to David, and so, da-da-da. But, and the spirit just comes through, I'm sure, in the time I met her, that was back around 1990, 1991, somewhere in that range, it was just comforting, you know, everything's well, he's in a good place, he's so grateful, you know, words of comfort and blessing. And then the more we go deeper with the spirit, we actually have experiences, mystical experiences, that we are not located, that we don't really occupy a coordinate in time and space, because we're everywhere. Because that, the idea of place is actually another concept. And dimensions, you know, it's like, oh, moving to another dimension, those are all concepts too. Basically what you'll find as you go on this journey, that your mind will be emptied of everything you think you know, about everything. And that's just the way that the journey goes. You find yourself getting happier and happier and happier as you go more into what I call the I do not know state of mind, which is really what forgiveness is about. And you become more happy, more confident, so that people can ask you questions about politics and you say, I don't know. And they ask you questions about Newtonian science, you say, I don't know. And they even ask you questions about even A Course in Miracles. I'm getting to the point now where it's fading. People will say, what lesson is da 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 da? I don't know. I used to have it all memorized, but that's going to. It just all disappears. I'm quite clueless now. I'm getting really clueless. Someone called in while we were in the car. This woman Don and Sundari said, "Oh, Don," and then Sundari apologized for not being able to, because Don apparently had called a lot of times, and then Don's like, "Oh, that's okay," and then was this and this and this, and we were just talking before Don called in about all things work together for good, it's all perfect, and then when Sundari apologized a second time to Don, I said, you don't have to do that. You don't have to. It's all perfect. And then I could hear Don kind of laughing. And, you know, that's the laughter comes in when we get in touch with that innocence, that we are all perfectly innocent.
That's
funny.
Yeah.
You know,
that there's never any cause to apologize. In essence, I mean, just with the perfection.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
The great poet.
You're always in the right place at the right time with the right people doing the right thing. And wow, wait a minute. There's nothing to feel bad about. There's nothing to feel guilty about. There's nothing I didn't do not perfect enough.
Yes.
I mean, that's a mind-boggling.
Well, remember that movie with Ally McGraw and Ryan O'Neal, Love Story? What was the line that was so famous from that? Love is never having to say, I'm sorry. My gosh, the prophetess, Ally McGraw. You know, it's all around us. It's in the love songs. Carol King, only love is real. Everything else, illusion, adding to the confusion. No way we connive at being alive. Tracing a line till we can define the thing that allows us to feel. Only love is real. I mean, it's, my gosh, we've had the Course in Miracles for centuries. We've had it, the content of the Course in ancient China. We've had it in the Vedas. You know, it's been around for us. And now this is just another form of the universal curriculum. And what it's basically saying, it's all one. Everything is one. Beautiful teaching. And now we're just starting to practically apply it and get happy. Start to say, yeah, this is my birthright. This is my inheritance. Bring it on. You know, I want to welcome it. I want to embrace the love. Embrace the light. This is fun. We're having fun.
Yeah, like, you know, when you said, like, bring it on, it makes me think that there's this song, I keep going back to that song I hear in the Christian radio, it says, your life is not falling apart, it's falling into place. And it's kind of like that, you know, like, things happen to you, like, once you go in the spiritual journey, and, you know, like, you have to let go of expectations. But at first you hold, and then it feels like it falls apart, but it's really like the trust you were talking about, that trust, that faith, knowing, like, I do not know my own best interest, but, you know, the Spirit knows, so it's like holding on to that trust, like knowing, you know, it's fine, I'm okay. And it's very humbling, and I mean, I like to hear you, because it reminds me that trust, yeah, that trust, I want to remember that day in and day out, because as life seems to fall apart, then I lose it and I get anxious and scared. Mm-hmm. So.
That's great. Yeah, it reminds me, I have all these songs I listen to, but that's reminding me of, I think is it Jason Gray, that song, More Like Falling in Love Than Something to Believe In? Yeah, that's a great song. I don't know, we have a sound system here, but I've got a little sound system. But caught up, called out, come take a look at me now. It's like I'm falling in love. And then it does mention Jesus. And it's so beautiful, because it's like life isn't falling apart. It's falling into place. Everything is falling into place, which just means it's all coming together in divine order. It's always been there, but now the awareness is like that. That's what Judy was talking about today too. We were just talking, marveling at how everything is working together for the good. Nothing has ever been out of place, and I had so much fun with that 4.5-hour lunch with her, because every time I have lunch with her, that's the fourth time, and I just marvel at the experiences she shares. That Jesus is so behind everything, absolutely everything. She did have a reading, a message that came to her that she was very close in a previous lifetime, close to awakening, and then she took a wrong turn, seemingly, and it was a lot of guilt with this one little step, so close, oh so close, one little step, and she was talking about it, and then it came to this lifetime where she had this message come in about a lawsuit. That would be her opportunity to come to full completion, was a lawsuit. And this was like a little bit, a few months, 3 or 4 months before the lawsuit that that she was involved in, that the foundation of A Course in Miracles and Foundation for Inner Peace got involved in that. And we just were smiling in the sense that it all played out just the way that it was scripted, just to come to a sense of completion, just to come to a sense of seeing the innocence beyond, like with a lawsuit, obviously you got to have two, you know, beyond the duality. However, whatever it takes to come to that, oh, let all the pieces fall into place, because they've always been in place. Some of you know that in the early part of the workbook, Jesus says, in no situation do you perceive your own best interest. He doesn't say in some situations or in most. He says, in no situation do you perceive your own best interest. Oh my gosh, is that wonderful or what? In no situation. Then, I was saying in the car today, what's so fun is then he says, I think it's the next lesson, everything is in your own best interest. Oh my gosh, he gives the answer. He doesn't just leave it hanging. He gives the answer. What does that mean? All things work together for good. Let all things be exactly as they are, you know. That it's only been a misinterpretation that the problem is. That's amazing to think that nothing ever has gone wrong. Wow. Hot ziggity dog, is that the top of the, that's the peak of understanding, of the only understanding. Well, well, we were talking on the way home, but Nikita was taken to a place of rest.
He was knocked down to a place of rest.
Involuntarily taken into rest. And she was going to be our tech support. She was going to come and search out a movie for us tonight. And I thought, well, I told her, I said, I think you should just go with the rest, and then we'll just let it unfold. So we still have a couple more gatherings here in the Bay Area.
Tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, because I really do want to show some kind of movie. I keep mentioning every day. I'm like, today is the day. Today is the day. I was sure today is the day. I was like, I'm going to come back at 4 and just join with my laptop and the TV, see what comes out of it. You know, I was looking forward to it. Got knocked down, so it wasn't happening. But maybe tomorrow, or the day after, I think there's something.
It could be a movie,
maybe
it could be some clips, or even a mini movie, a compressed movie for teaching purposes. But it always comes out of a question.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody shows up and they are calling out for love and there's something that's really there, then the movie seems to come in as an answer.
Like in Topanga on our last day, you guys won't believe it, but I'm going to mention this over and over. But like on our last day, it was the end of the retreat. The retreat ended at 5 p.m. We were there around like 7 p.m. just like gathering, and there's like all this gratitude, just like a few of us. And there's this prayer in the heart. I could feel it. Like there's just this deep prayer. Like you could just feel it bursting. And then all of a sudden it comes out. Like I think all of them at the same time were like they really wanted to maximize the rest of the evening, because that was like the last night. And they're like, we want to spend it. We want some kind of an experience, a movie or a session that would just blow our hearts open. Just like blow it open. And it's like, okay. And what came in was Revolver and the Nines. But that was the answer to that prayer, and it was a really deep session.
But that was because it was so, like, it was just it was just boiling there. So, yeah, it was really deep.
The nines.
And
yeah, those are mind blowers.
The nines. Yeah.
We just showed a mini movie of Revolver and one clip from The Nines, but it was like they were so cute, they hadn't seen either, and they were like, oh my God.
They had to pause it. They're like, when they came down to The Nines, they're like, okay, whoa, pause it. Then, like, can we rewind it? They're like, what is going on?
It's almost like, this is in a motion picture? I can't believe this. Yeah. It's like, they're saying on the screen, you know. Because it's almost like the deepest thing you could ever experience in your heart. But when it's acted out on the big screen, that's like a mind opener. It's almost like a drug experience without the drugs. Just into a shift of perception, you know, having your mind spring open. The topic came up about ayahuasca, and Nikita's like, here we go. It's ayahuasca, wherever I go, it's ayahuasca. So they're in the car, and it's like, did you take ayahuasca? She said, technically no, but, you know, it's all around you.
Yeah.
Come out to California, you got to show everyone your California shirt. She got a California sparkly shirt from the airport, LAX. She's wearing it again.
That looks good on you.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
So we're out here, we're
like
in the
movies.
Land of spark.
I want to say movies better than ayahuasca. I never got to ayahuasca, but I was always praying white coming in. I was always praying like for the expansion, like experiential, something to totally expand the mind. And it was like ayahuasca drugs. And I was like, I hear it, but it's just like I'm really not guided. I'm not judging it. Like, I'm the most open-minded person, like, when it comes to these things, but I'm like not guided. And yet every time there's a movie, it's like, whoa, that's like, that is so mind-blowing. And there's no, it's like, there's no low after that. It's like, you don't have to.
Do you want to see the plug right now? I mean, do you want to connect?
Do you want to connect? I don't know. We don't know.
I think
probably not tonight.
Unless you felt to show a clip, if anything,
if
you have an inspired clip.
Should I grab?
That's right, we said 7 to 10, so
right.
There's still time for a mind-blowing, mind-altering clip.
Because I have my son.
Right. So no.
Half an hour.
Like this, a Star Trek. Star Trek be too long without the commercials.
David, while she's thinking about this, really, what is a movie? I mean, she would show us a Cannes movie, but isn't this a movie? Aren't we acting in a movie right now?
This was our version of the movie. We continued on with the use of the movies.
Yeah.
We also meditate.
Yes.
But you don't need to hook. Is our computer working? You need yours, right?
I don't know.
No. B said Star Trek. There's actually so many. Well, the thing is, we've got so many Star Trek mini movies that are mind-altering, mind-blowing segments around memory and all kinds of things. One of them is called Remember Me.
Uh-huh.
That I don't know if that might even be. Within our
that's
range.
A 45-minute
45.
One.
Okay.
Star Trek's are all 45.
Mm-hmm.
Half an hour to 45 minutes.
Well, very good. We have, you mentioned meditating. I've got my little boombox here, my mini boombox. And the taste, it would be if there's any kind of a taste. Would have to be like a theme, if somebody has
a theme
or a pressing question.
Maybe something will come in, like, what was the theme? What were the themes?
Well, we're talking
talking about the ego a lot. Like, what about the Revolver movie? Like, the kid when he goes up the elevator, would that be helpful, you think?
Anything related to anger?
Anger management. I feel pretty. I'm so pretty. Jack Nicholson, a scene going over the bridge with Adam Sandler. That's a good movie. Anger management. Yeah. I was mentioning last night we have this Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment, MWGE.org, and you can go through the emotional list index and then type in something like anger or jealousy or whatever the issue, and then, yeah, they just, they come up.
E.org.
We even have an animated character that was invented for that, called Mr. Pops. He's a popcorn bag that is watching movies and he blows his top. He gets angry, and then he needs to need some movie watching help, and then Mr. Pops becomes serene, becomes more like Yoda. So it's a little animation.
How about something around transcending special relationships and role playing? Because I feel like a lot many questions were asked around that today.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can. Now that we don't have anything set up, I can share a movie that I showed in Southern California. I can do it verbally, like David said. This is all a movie anyway. So, I've had some people tell me that they like my versions of telling the movies better than watching the movies themselves. Sure. They go, oh yeah, I saw it, but your version of you telling the movie is better than watching the movie. That is a classic movie at transcending roles, transcending expectations. You've got an operating system with voice of Scarlett Johansson, the soft feminine voice, and an operating system, and eventually she becomes interested with other OS systems, and eventually Alan Watts, there's a group in Northern California that are working with Alan Watts' operating system, very intuitive, and then she starts communicating, and then she gets into simultaneous communications, when he's like, who are you talking to? Are you talking to other people? And I don't know how many hundreds of other people she's talking to simultaneously. And are you in love with other people? Because we're so used to relationships where
one-on-one.
It's one-on-one, or in San Francisco, the Bay Area. You can't get away with that here. Are you people watching at home? You should move out here to San Francisco. You feel stuck. You know, it really takes it. I think that is one of the most amazing things, because to me that shows the direction that this is moving in. That shows the direction in our seeming lifetimes of what we're going into. Going into from the idea of relationships as they've been defined into being used by the Holy Spirit, letting the Holy Spirit orchestrate, we'll say, the configurations. Well, even when two people come together in a relationship, that's like a little mini community. That's a configuration we call a partnership or a marriage or a couple or so on and so forth. And before Yogananda passed on, you know, he felt there would be these new configurations coming, study groups, people coming together, opening up for self-realization together. You know, through, he was mentioning Kriya Yoga and his practices, but I feel like that's coming. Like it could be that years from now, seemingly, you may look back and go, my gosh, I can't believe how my consciousness has shifted. I can't believe the configurations that the Spirit is bringing in. They're nothing what I imagined them to be, but that's how the parable of David has gone. It's just gone into configurations, world travels. I wasn't a traveler. I never even enjoyed traveling. but I was willing to do whatever for healing. So there's all kinds of configurations that came in and coming together for a period of time and then apart and then together. You know, it's whatever it takes to wake the mind up. And I did say that. I remember with this young group that was down there in Southern California, most of whom I'd never met. There was some people there that I'd met before, but I'll say the same thing to you all, that I said to them, I said, we are in a lifelong relationship. We have been brought together in this configuration by a purpose. Quantum, that's how these bodies seem to be in this room. It's the purpose that drew us together. It's nothing from the past. We have different past histories, different cultural backgrounds. We seem to have different races, sexes, all different kinds of orientations and interests and intellectual capabilities and all kinds of skills that are different. And yet, we have one unifying purpose that has drawn us together. And I would say that's the purpose that will bring us joy. That this whole thing that seems like a room in Sundari's house, we could call it that if we want, but yeah, she was saying today, but this configuration has come about because of our calling, because of our purpose. And we can trust that. We can trust to go in that direction. This configuration seems to be a temporary, momentary configuration, but it will continue to be that way. That's how we outgrow the status quo. That's how we outgrow thinking we have to have the form be a certain way for us to be safe. No, we don't. We need a purpose that we're very aligned with to be safe. That's like an alignment with Source. That's where our safety and security comes in. Jesus says it in so many ways, but when two people come together with the same purpose, where two or more are gathered in my name, I am there. And not only that, but if one needs something, the other is sent to provide it. Instead of thinking we are each responsible for providing for our own body and providing for our own care and maintenance and our own survival and everything, we can start to trust that there is one who's in charge of the plan of awakening, and if one is sent, he talks about this in the psychotherapy pamphlet, where the patient and the therapist come together. Sometimes one is sent to give money to the other, other times no. But when the patient and the therapist come together, they come together for healing. And whatever one needs, the other provides. Imagine if you thought of your life that every time you have a holy encounter, that it's for God's purposes, and whatever one needs is provided. It could be a hug, it could be a smile, it could be some money, it could be just, can I hold you, can we rejoice together in something like an experience. Judy was talking a lot about those being drawn together with certain ones and feeling this kind of connection. Like she felt with Helen when she met, she said the day when she met Helen Schuckman for the first time, it was more like, oh, I feel it. There's something for us. And she felt that with her husband, Witt. And she felt that with her first husband, Bob. And she felt that with Deborah, who was with us, you know, there's this purposeful thing like, there's something greater that we're here for. We feel the resonance, we feel the connection. And that's why I say that to everyone I meet, we are in a lifelong relationship based on a purpose. This isn't kind of a thing where we're coming together to like marry somebody necessarily just in the worldly sense, but it's a joining in purpose for the duration of our lives, however that long is.
You know, what you just said about Sundari's house, it was so, so powerful for me in an answer to a question about my mother, my daughter, of your saying, my mother, my daughter. And it really got me started on a path where, you know, I talked about myself as the vehicle instead of my body, and the one I call daughter or the one I call mother, rather than, it was just noticing. You got me to notice all the places and times and internal ways that it was my. You know, there was some way that really, really helped me transition to what you're saying right now, being the script is written and there's walking through it, so it isn't my daughter and my house and might as well be my David. I mean, none of it is my. And that is really, really powerful seed you planted that seemed to help me look at what you're talking about right now.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that's all behind that flash of insight you had too, that time and judgment are the same. They're identical.
From watching Mr. Nobody next to you.
from that mystical movie where we had that experience. I think we were up in Petaluma, weren't we? That was Lucy.
That was the same thing.
That
was the weirdest thing. I was there was the commentary on the site has me and you in it. And so there I was in Petaluma, David and I, watching David and I. And the thing was that I literally lost track of which reality I was in. Because I was at your movie festival when I first, that was filmed.
That was filmed, yes.
And somehow, literally watching it, I couldn't just, both realities were like so real that I didn't know which one I was in while I was in.
Oh my,
like
that's a metaphysical compliment to the Holy Spirit.
I really lost where I was.
Yeah, that was fun.
You know, that
was a lot of fun.
And honestly, my mind just got lost in that, where I didn't know which one I was in, because they were both, the simultaneity of it was, I mean, it's almost like there's only the now and all the past lives are happening just right here now at once. All the future lives are equally exactly here and now, and it was that kind of complete reality for me.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Something about that everything that happens here is because of a purpose. And so is the only purpose I can think of, not that I can think of, but that my heart tells me there would be, feel the oneness, feel whole again. Because I remember from since I was very little, I noticed that I wasn't whole. Like I had this feeling that I wasn't whole, and somehow my life would be about becoming whole. But then, is that something I was born with, or is that something that was created? Because then it takes it out of, if this is a dream and this is not real, then how could there be a real purpose into this, woven into this dream life? And where does the purpose come from? Is the purpose coming from somewhere else, or is it like
yeah.
you need a little bit of
yeah.
clarity about
the purpose
it?
Is coming from the Holy Spirit, and the purpose is not, it doesn't indwell in the dream. It dwells in the mind, so it's a way of looking. All Bill Thetford said to Helen Schuckman at the beginning, there must be a better way, and he thought she would just make a joke or laugh whatever. And she said, you're right, Bill, and I'll help you find it. Boom, there we go. You know, it was the query was answered. And, well, there's so many great ways I could come at this, but basically, let's just start with, like, for example, the body. The eyes of the body are not receptors. You know, all the stuff that we were taught about light waves coming in, you know, through the pupil and through the retina, and then the image is upside down, and then it gets flipped and reinterpreted, and then this little neurons are sent, and we're interpreting. That's all a lie, too. All the stuff we were taught in science is all a lie, too. The eyes are not receptors. And neither are the ears. Remember, we learned things about the ear waves, and they come in, and they go inside, and they touch the eardrum, and then they send neurological impulses to the brain, and then the brain interprets. None of that's true. That's all a lie. The eyes are symbolically projectors, and the ears are like speakers. So the mind, consciousness, through its association, generates these things, concepts called noise. It's not coming from the world. If a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it, does it make a sound? Philosophical question. Well, I'll tell you one thing. If there's no perceiver, there's definitely no sound. But perception comes from consciousness, is generated and radiated outward. So the eyes are projectors. They're like our little movie projectors. Talking about the movie, the dream David was. There's our projectors. And here's our sound. Dolby sound in stereo. We got it going on. The body is being used by the mind, by consciousness, as a projector. Now, this is the fun part about quantum physics, because there's really no such thing as linear time. So what I'm saying is, the closer you come to the projector, which is really in the mind, but we'll say the eyes, the closer you come to the projector and everything, the more you think of it in terms of space, and the farther away from the projector you think of it as time. Like if I said, well, I seem to be maybe like 10, 12 feet away from you. You see, 12 feet, that's a spatial thing. I don't say I'm 0.01 seconds away from you. You say, what? What are you talking about? Or if you spread it out, like in terms of stars, let's say we move to the stars. Now, stars are so far away, you just have so many zeros behind the miles. If you did it in terms of miles or kilometers, the numbers would be so big that we don't describe how far the stars are away from the projectors by spatial terms. Oh, that's so many billion miles away, or whatever, tens, hundreds of billions of miles. We say light years.
Right.
Oh, years. Oh my gosh, we're describing something that we perceive that seems to be a long distance away, but we're talking about years. And then if you want to go even further, project it to history, if you said to somebody, how far away is Cleopatra? If you tried to tell that person that she was so many miles away, they would say, what are you talking about? Is it a costume party? Cleopatra's been dead for centuries. What do you mean, how far is she away? But then you describe it entirely in terms of time. How many hundreds of years? Not in terms of space. Oh, she's about a trillion miles away. People say, are you crazy? The farther it is away from the projectors, the more it's described in terms of time. Now here's the good part. If you follow me on this, that we'll just say we seem to be projecting Sundari's house, Sundari's room. And I would say that this, what we're perceiving right here, is the entire cosmos. That there's actually nothing outside of these walls. There's no such thing as San Francisco. There's no such thing as Oakland. There's no such thing as the United States. There's no oceans. This is it. Look around you. Sundari's house is the entirety of the universe, because our eyes are projecting it, and it's just ideas. There aren't really actualities there. You can start to go into this state of mind where you start to bring it all back closer to your projectors. Ooh, it's really fun. It's exciting. I used to do that. I'd be over traveling around, and let's say I'm in France or Belgium or anything, and then they start to talk and they say, well, what's going on in the United States? I say, what? And they say, United States, across the ocean. I say, what? There is no United States. You all know this from John Lennon's song, Imagine. Imagine there's no country. I wonder if you can. How willing are you to just start to reel it back into your projection? Mm-hmm. Now, there was, what was the guy's name with the headless way? But I can never keep track of all these names. He was just basically saying that no one ever sees their head. That they kind of sometimes look into the thing called a mirror, but really, is that really real? I mean, are there really mirrors? You know, it's like we have this view of looking out from something and perceiving something. We may perceive other heads, but you've never ever directly looked on your head. Are you sure it's really there? You can go like this, like Lee's doing, and see even with the hands, but are you sure they're really there?
I've seen pictures.
pictures, photographs and everything.
Yeah.
And that's a pretty sneaky trick. That those are kind of the mirrors, pictures, those are convincing, yeah.
It's just more illusion.
Yeah, it's really interesting when you start to realize that Jesus says, projection makes perception. So all of perception, everything that's perceived into seemingly the external world is just a projection of thoughts. But what does Jesus tell us? Ideas lead not their source. What does that mean? So it means in heaven, Christ never left the mind of God. Christ still abides in God's love. Christ is still spirit, spirits in spirit. Light is still light. Oneness is still oneness. And in this world, that ideas lead not their source, it just means that Krishnamurti said that many times. I am the world is me. Something resonated about that when I heard Krishnamurti say, I am the world is me. The ego's like, that's the most air you. It's seeing it as if it's a man speaking. But that's no man. I am the world is me. My heart was bursting in love when I would hear that I am the world is me. Why would my heart burst with Krishnamurti? What a kind, generous, loving expression. I used to watch him sitting there with all these people questioning him, and they'd question him, then they'd start screaming and shouting at him. It was the most amazing thing. I'd watch him, the people would start screaming at him, and I'd look at him to see how's he going to react to all this shouting. He said, Madams, sirs, please, can we come back to the question? That's how he reacted to shouting. I was like, oh my God. My heart just exploded with love. I thought, oh my God, what a reflection. That was just a reflection of what was in my own heart, of that you could be loving. And that love wasn't circumstance dependent. Jesus could be loving in a crowd, in a mob that was saying, crucify him. Because why? He didn't take it personally. Because there was no person there. You know, it wasn't that the man, there was not a man to take it personal. So to me, that's beautiful when we start to think that actually with us here is the whole cosmos. And the presence of love that's here is everywhere. It's not a spatial thing.
Yeah, you were talking about person, like, and then, like, Sundari's house, and I just finished the module, Holy Relationship, and oh my god, it's, so much came out. I mean, it was going through a lot, and but what I got was, I think I shared this with you on our last call, was this idea of ownership, like I own something, or I own a car or a house, or I have this much money. It's so insane, like the whole concept doesn't even make sense to me anymore right now. I can't even tell people, like, oh yeah, I own a house. I can't even say it, because every time I say it, I feel like this heaviness, you know, like it just reemphasizes the personhood.
Yeah.
I know, like, I am this individual, so I own this thing, or I own this, or even say my mother, like, my children, like, it's almost like I own them. Like, you know, like, I'm owning a role. And I don't know what I'm trying to say, but the ownership thing is crazy. It's such a ego strategy to kind of reemphasize the separation. Like, yeah, you are an individual, you're going to own this, and you own this, you own these people, you own your husband, you own your wife, no one can touch them, you know, no one can harm your children. Like, it's such a heavy, heavy responsibility.
Yes, it is. I like that saying in the Spanish tradition, mi casa, su casa. Mm-hmm. Imagine that's actually God speaking that. My house is your house.
It's so light.
Totally shared. I did feel that when I come here with Sundari. I felt it when I was just down in Topanga Canyon, where it was like I was swamped with all these amazing young people that were just like, oh, we love having you here, and come anytime, and come unannounced, and just come and make yourself at home. And oh, so gracious and loving. And it didn't have any sense of ownership. In fact, I think everyone else there felt it too. People were showing up, and one comes up with her baby, and the dogs come in there, and it just all melted together in that. And I think that's kind of interesting, because isn't that what we want to give? Is there's something in our heart that just wants to share everything. It just wants to say there's no ownership. This is all perception. The Holy Spirit's sharing our world with us, thankfully, and sharing the purpose so that we can rise up in vision. And to give you an example, I had a young man call me from Portugal the other day when I was down in Southern California, and I knew of him, Rafael, and he's 23 years old, and it was the first time he's called me. We've emailed, and he said, I had to call you. And he's having all these mystical experiences, like transcendent mystical experiences, and the flip side is he's having this pain in his body. So he's going flipping into mystical experience, pain, mystical experience, pain, mystical experience, pain. And then in the pain, it just goes where he starts to lose all of his five senses. There's a movie that we have that we show sometime called Perfect Sense, where all of humanity, one by one, the senses go. It's an amazing movie to watch. One, the senses go, and then another sense goes, then another sense go. And at the very end, when the final fifth sense is going out, the main two characters are coming together, and they can't see, feel, taste, smell, touch each other, and they just kind of fall together and embrace, and the senses are gone. And it's a very powerful movie. Well, here I get a call from Raphael, and his five senses are leaving, all of them, going out. He used to love to cook. He used to be able to use his eyes to read. He's like, David, I can't read anymore. And I can't watch your videos. I used to love to watch your videos, but I'm getting to the point where I can't watch the videos anymore. And I can't hear. And he was going to that. He was amazed that we could have this conversation. He said, I just dialed the number, and I just was like, spirit, 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 spirit. And then he was like, I can hear you now, but I can't listen to any audios anymore, and I can't watch any YouTube videos anymore, and I'm losing all my five senses. And he said, I just want to know, I just want to know that, that love and God are not abandoning me. Because when the mind's associated with the five, with the body, that's like getting snuffed out. That's like loss getting projected out, losing all the five senses. So we joined and I talked and I said, oh, you're so loved, Raphael, and God loves you so much, and you're going into the light. That's what the mystical experiences are. You're coming into that union, and then the fear and the resistance is just swinging down to this scenario with the body where he was afraid. He said, is there something I can do? Is there something immediate that can be done? I said, well, I'll make a call. I called Kirsten, and I said, here's the phone number and an email. I want you to communicate with Raphael and feel into inviting him to Mexico. And so she did. She talked with him and so on and so forth. And then in their call, Kirsten found herself, the spirit coming through her, because when I first met Kirsten, she had had two major accidents, head injuries. She had had a brain injury, I guess it was on a mountain bike and then skiing, and she'd had head injuries, and she was highly sensitized to sounds, like a plane flying overhead would be like torturous, like a razor blade scraping, or any kind of noise, a lawnmower would be deafening, because she was just through this head injury, and came through her all this to Raphael, like, oh, I can relate exactly to what's going on with your high sensitization and the senses. And so the spirit just poured through her, and he was, oh, he was just so thrilled. It was almost like he was thinking, I'm going down fast, and I'm in desperate prayer for some kind of thing. So then Kirsten talked with him, and he was quite, I think, overjoyed and thrilled with the way the spirit said, no, this is just a projection of fear. That's what's going on with the five senses seeming to disappear. That's just a projection of the ego's fear of loss. And it's projected to time and to the body. So anyway, it was very, very good. And then finally, because I said to Kirsten, I think you're really going to feel Raphael. And sure enough, Kirsten could totally feel the love of in this reflected in this man. So then Kirsten called me back, we talked again and everything, and I said, yeah. She said, Mexico is so loud. You know, the Mexicans, they celebrate all the saints and marching bands going on and donkeys going on and dogs barking, horses. It's just my horses and my donkeys sound alike. I have to work on this. And so there's a dog, and then the birds, and it's like there's so many sounds on there. And we both talked. We said, "Yeah, that's Mexico's not going to work at this point." He's like when she had her head injury, she's so sensitized to the slightest noise. And Mexico is like, I don't know what the decibel level is in the middle of the night. You know, it's like Mardi Gras going on. They actually do a Mardi Gras for so many days, and the horns blasting, and this, at 3 a.m, 4 to 5 a.m. So we both said, no, that's Mexico's never working. And then I thought, the monastery. So I said, call Suzanne, because Suzanne's out at our pristine, quiet monastery. Sundari knows, it's just out there. It's perfect, it's so quiet. You hardly have a plane go by, it's way up in there, you can hardly hear any sound. It's pristinely quiet. So I said, talk to Suzanne and see what Suzanne feels. So Kirsten poured her heart out and the whole experience with Raphael and everything. Suzanne's like, I feel it. She could feel the spirit, the tickle in her heart. Like, oh, yeah, Raphael, I feel him coming in. So that's in progress now. So even something as extreme as like you're saying, I can't even talk about ownership, and I'm going deeper into this module, and I'm going deeper into this experience, spirit takes care. And this little parable with Raphael is a good example of that. Like, he was kind of at rope's end of things, and just like, I have to call you, David, I have to talk to you. And that just initiated just what he needed. His parents even, they adore him, but they don't know how to handle it. What do you do when you have a 23-year-old son? You think you've got a problem with David here. What if your 23-year-old son is having mystical experiences and then going into extreme pain, and he can't seem to cook, bathe himself, do anything. He has no skills, no abilities. Imagine trying to place your son somewhere where he has no skills and abilities to contribute in any way. And they were feeling probably hopeless, and they were also feeling some of those same feelings, like, "What? How can I help you?" He said, "I'm going to call David." It's good, good. And then this whole thing unfolded. So it's the spirit taking care. And then they also, he said, yeah, he told Kirsten, I think they'll buy me a round-trip plane ticket. Well, that's practical. And they're very grateful to do that and offer some money, maybe 500 euros a month for living expenses and whatever. They're thrilled that there's actually a place that he can go to where he can feel, ah, I'm safe. Ah, oh, I'm loved. Oh, I may not be able to lift a finger, and I'm loved unconditionally, without question. You know, that's what we all have to remember. That's how much God loves us. That as we go on this journey of awakening and things seem to even fall away, that we're loved. Looking at Witt and Judy today, 83, Judy's I think 83 or 84, and Witt's maybe 87, you know, they're so loved. Oh, they're so loved and nurtured. The bodies are doing what bodies seem to do. They seem to get older, they get more frail. Judy's been telling us, what is it, glaucoma, macular degeneration of the eyes, and different things, and she was saying this reading she even had when she had her child 60 years ago. She, with the oxygen mask, and swallowed her own vomit and was like pneumonia and came, you know, very close to dying, but she had pushed it out of awareness, and this reading brought it back. So her lungs were weak, and you know, the bodies seem to get old, they seem to get weak, they seem to get frail, they seem to break down, and so on and so forth. But if you're not a body, why should that worry the mind? If we don't own a body, you know, when we say my body, that's being kind of arrogant. It's like, I don't think that's really true. And yet, that's a source of much stress when we take the my word and we attach it to a body, then that's it. So that's the message. We're saved, we're loved. And that this awakening is the most important thing. And that, you know, if it starts to fade away and fade away and things fall away, you know, the Spirit's like saying, I'm here for you. I'm here for you. You know, because this is everything. When I see people that seem to be going through a dismantling, I think that's the most glorious thing, because they're just opening towards a remembrance of who they are. And the Spirit will do everything to support that. Whereas the ego is going, oh, that's not looking good. The ego is afraid of going into insanity. But what the world calls insanity, like psychosis, for example, if you go into the DSM 3 or 4, the definition of psychosis is a break from reality. Well, that's what the human condition is. It's a break from reality. The entire human condition is a psychotic break. Human beings don't have psychotic breaks. The whole condition, the human race, is a psychotic break from reality, heaven. Oh, we flip the definition around. Schizophrenic, split. That's the human race again. Split mind. Hearing multiple voices. That's another condition of schizophrenia, right? What do you think planet Earth is about? We've got 7 billion different voices talking. And if you listen to them all. You watch television, YouTube, you you tune in on the internet, you get to hear all the... We're listening to multiple voices. All of us are listening to multiple voices. The human race has schizophrenia. I think it should be locked up. It should be locked up. It's dangerous. It could harm itself. It may blow itself up. Or you can forgive and realize that there's nothing outside your mind, that you're not going insane, you're coming into sanity. Inward to sanity. Be still. So that's the thing to just be reminded of, that as you give yourself over, all the support of God, all the support of Holy Spirit, all the support of the angels are all there in abundance. And that's important to remember. You will not go on alone from here. Mighty companions go with you. They may seem to be angelic visions, they may seem to be human beings that are like angels. It's so important, especially the deeper you go, you have to have a sense of that. I would do anything for you. Anything. Yeah. Okay.
Should I make some announcements?
Yeah.
So, by the way, I forgot to say welcome to you. I'm so happy you all came. It makes me so happy to see you and to have this house have some functionality. So it's, of all existing here with your love and light, and it makes me really happy.